it's state of the art. The best that money and modern technology can build.
And you expect me to sit back and accept this?
It's home to the worst criminals in Texas. It's a great deterrent.
I cannot function in your cell!
It is also a monument to human failure. Cell Block C of the Estelle High Security Unit of the Texas Department of Criminal Justice. Listen. The yelling, the screaming, the noise is pretty much of a constant reality in this place, although most of the time only a tiny handful of people will hear it. This is the sound of bedlam, the voices of men so violent or incorrigible or uncontrollable that they have been dropped into the bottom of a modern sanitary pit, where there is neither day nor night, where, in theory at least, they can neither threaten nor injure another inmate or any of the men and women who guard them. If they follow the rules here, they will be brought outside to exercise in one of these cages for 1 hour, three times a week. The rest of the time, the remaining 165 hours of every week, they are locked in the solitary confinement of these cells. This is where we begin and where we will end our series this week, in cell block C. Some such units are known as Supermax. Here, it's known as SEG, or ADSEG, Administrative Segregation. This may not be exactly what all of us had in mind, but this is the logical outcome of what we said we wanted. We have been offended, many of us, by the impression that life in prison is too easy. We associate games with country clubs. And taxpayers have grown increasingly offended at the notion that prisons provide entertainment and generous parole, when what they thought they were buying was a precise and definite period of punishment.
I think it's important to remember that for 10 years and even more, we had a revolving door in this system. I think the citizens of this state and probably across this country have said, no more. We don't want these criminals out on the streets, roaming the streets to harm our families and our friends. And they're willing to pay that price, whatever the dollar figure is.
Here in Texas, parole has effectively become almost non-existent.
Parole is like, I guess, money was in the 1930s. It ain't there.
Good time, providing early release for good behavior, is a thing of the past.
Take the freedom away, what have we got? You're putting us up against a wall more and more every day.
With fewer prisoners being released early and more criminals receiving mandatory sentences, the prison population here in Texas has tripled over the last 7 years, and doing time has grown harder.
It seems like they're trying to provoke people now, you know, like little stuff like, I don't know, man, it's always they're taking things and they're not giving nothing.
Good, say the taxpayers. Exactly what we wanted, say the voters. But there's always a price. With fewer incentives for good behavior, there was more violence. There was an increase in the size and influence of prison gangs. Convicts were killing and injuring other convicts, attacking corrections officers, which in turn led to an expansion in administrative segregation.
One gate. Two gate.
The WIN unit is a maximum security unit. Well, segregation is the maximum security of a maximum security unit, so you're going to use a lot higher security precautions than you would.
This is one of the older ANSEG units.
Second down.
Here, the inmates are permitted out of their cells every day for the brief walk down the hall to the showers.
Open your mouth. Raise your arm.
The men are strip searched.
Big it mouth.
Their clothing is examined. Then, before they're taken out of their cells, the inmates are handcuffed. Two guards escort each man down the hall behind a rolling shield that protects them from assault by other inmates. Otherwise, the only breaks in the day come at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting as far as day and night, and I'm not sure of days. It's been numerous days, I would say weeks, maybe even a couple of months.
And now we're supposed to be functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor, but this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. ANSEG at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact. And you can see the sky.
You got eight?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others. But then, too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the ANSEG unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, put your mouth, foot, turn, turn around. Turn around. Lift your left foot, right foot, bend over, spread your cheeks.
Everything went SOP, standard operating procedures. I've known him quite some time through his incarceration.
Barker is going to ANSEG for assaulting a guard, but assaulting a guard can be as simple as a verbal threat.
He's a very passive individual. He's also a manipulator by bad behavior. He might stand his own for a while until he decided to go the easy way out and maybe do a staff assault and get locked up.
Every time we leave, they strip us to make sure we don't got nothing. I'm used to it now. Happens. Every time we come out, gotta get used to it.
The second prisoner awaiting transfer, Willie Madlock.
Mr. Madlock, you're going over to administrative segregation, is that correct?
Right.
Have you been over there before?
No.
You know what it's like?
No. No.
You have any idea?
No.
Everything was going fantastic. Just standard operating procedures. He got out of all his clothes. And then he was told to turn around and bend over and spread his cheeks, which he turned around, bent over, and didn't spread his cheeks.
Giving you a direct order now, like to bend over and spread his cheeks. Paper from the strip search.
And I said, here we go.
Let's redo it and do it the right way. Yeah. I'll go get the old saying, we'll get it right. Yeah. So you're gonna deal with it now, or if I go get the OC.
All I'm saying, man.
All I'm saying is you're gonna do it, or I'm going to get the OC pepper spray, and we'll properly strip search it in. Well, so you need to go ahead and drop your doors and do what the officer tells you to do. What is it gonna be?
See me. Look.
What is it gonna
be? Since I've been here, man, y'all been talking about us, man, since we talked about video.
Go ahead and get the OC. He's refusing to proper strip search, so.
I'm not trying to cause no trouble, man. It's just that they be going beyond the call of duty trying to dog and abuse us, make us look like we are animals, dogs, or something. Man, you know, we human too.
I'll tell you what, this is your opportunity to talk and give your story on TV, and you're fixing to lose it because you don't want to do a proper strip search.
I'm not trying to lose it, man.
Then get out of your doors. Let's go with it. Are you going to do it or not? Bob, get up here and do your strip search.
I told him, Mike Willie, that he had an opportunity to tell his story. And I told him he has this last chance, which he doesn't normally have. And he took it.
Put your lips. Put your hands. Pull behind your ears. Put your testicles. Put your arms and hands up. Turn around. Show me. Pull your feet, shoes off. Show them the bottom of your left foot and your right foot. Bend over and spread your cheeks. Okay, put your shorts on.
Let's get dressed and get on over there.
I feel like that it was unnecessary, that it was done for the main purpose to degrade me. They normally don't do it. They do it as a form of punishment.
The trip to the new high security and SEG unit at Estella Prison takes just a few moments.
You don't have no view of the outside. And you have very few contact with other people and stuff.
How old are you?
21.
What are you in?
Murder.
What did you murder?
Next door neighbor.
Why?
Dope.
Willie Matlock is serving 25 years on a burglary conviction.
A lot of guys that came back over to where I was from over here, they was giving us horror stories and stuff. Like, you know, guys getting killed, they'd be refusing to, you know, feed you and running on your gas. And, like, they believe this is kind of like a doggone death camp, kind of like one of those Nazi concentration camps.
David Barker bears the scars of an earlier suicide attempt. Major William De La Rosa, who runs the ADSEG unit, must assess and classify the new inmates.
My mind tells me that I see a passive, vulnerable inmate. He's bent over, kind of clinging onto to himself, and he steps up to me and hardly says anything. I see that David's trying to get away, run away from something, and I don't see no disciplinary problem.
And you've been a chronic rule violator, so for your initial third-day period over here, I'm going to remain you a level two inmate. If the committee concurs with me, that's where you'll be for at least 30 days. Do you have any questions?
Clear the hallway!
I feel that David got exactly where he wanted to put himself in, and now he's here.
I gotta do it. I gotta stay here and do it. Can't be no harder. Don't come here. It ain't no place to be.
Come
Willie, when he came in, of course, I've already been informed that and prepared that he was giving them problems in the main building. And in this case, it was a strip search. So I'm perceiving a problem.
You have two staff assaults. Your latest one was on 7/10 of 97, which was striking an officer. I'm going to remain you a level 3, starting off here, and in the next 30 days, we'll reevaluate you again.
And they had already made their decision. They were just going through the formalities. And, you know, I felt like I was being treated like, you know, like livestock or something.
He's got a stand-up posture. I see Willie doing exactly what he wants to do, or he thinks what he wants to do. I told Willie, I don't see you having any problem over here as long as you do what's mandated. Do you have a problem with that? And his answer was no, sir.
This also created a whole lot of, you know, mental problems. I would be willing to believe of half the people over here on some kind of psych medication. Being locked up in these cells 23, 24 hours, 7 days a week, most people break after a year or two. Most people break.
Yesterday, when I went to Willie Madlock's cell in cell block C, we talked for almost half an hour.
I got to ask you, Willie, you could play the game, right?
Right.
You could play by the rules. You could say, all right, I'm going to keep my nose clean, and I'm just going to, I'm going to try and make it out of here.
Right.
I don't get the sense that's the way you're, that's the way you're made, though. I mean, you look upon this as kind of a challenge. I mean, I've got to say, I have sort of grudging admiration for you, but you know, there's an easy way and there's a hard way.
If you lose control over yourself, you'll never get it back. I mean, it's easier to be on the outside looking in and, you know, judging, and you know, it's like this here. Person can only submit so much, man. You know, before he he loses his manhood. That's the way I see it.
I've asked you a lot of questions. Anything you want to say?
Yeah, I'll tell you that. All we want, man, is for, you know, whatever reason you all is giving this story. We hope it be a two-sided, you know, story, you know, tell, you know, both sides of it. See, most people out there in America, they could care less about us, right? They feel like, you know, lock them up, make them do as much time, make it as, you know, hard as possible. But it's also another, you know, side, you know, to it too, is that people still need to be treated, you know, human, man. Even though we are here rightfully, because you can't send us back out there, you know, into the world, you know, all, you know, angry, you know, without no hope, man. All that's gonna do is cause more, you know, more and more problems.
There is another side to the story. There is always another side to the story. The victims of the crimes that put these men here, they are neither seen nor heard in this place. The correctional officers who walk the corridors with such authority and so much power, many of them, especially the newer officers, are in fact poorly trained, underpaid, and often very afraid themselves.
Slowly, 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 do not run. Now break apart, break apart.
These men and women are trainees. applicants for the Texas Department of Criminal Justice.
Get that, open them up. Get your eyes open, force them up.
It burnt. It set your chest real tight, couldn't breathe.
What is good news for the rest of the country, low unemployment and a booming economy, is bad news for the Texas Department of Criminal Justice. At a time when the system is desperate for reinforcements, when the number of inmates has tripled since 1989, the cream of the crop, the best candidates, are opting for better paying, less dangerous jobs.
Okay, when we do this area, or whatever, and then you move down the front to the cross area, and you work your way down, and make sure you feel very thoroughly so you won't miss anything.
Always shake down an area, okay? This is another thing that we're inspecting for, okay? Things like this. These things have been found.
They will confront men who are dangerous, angry, often psychotic. Men who have nothing but time on their hands. And those who are assigned to the ADSEG unit at Estelle will always have, in the backs of their minds, the knowledge that most of those inmates were considered too dangerous to leave in the general prison population.
We're supposed to punch him, abuse him?
I would not say they're unqualified. Our training does meet minimal standards for correctional officer training. I do believe that the training should be increased.
In point of fact, the demand is so great, the training has been decreased from 6 weeks to four.
Well, I think the training, if you listen, is adequate. I mean, to protect yourself.
Defensive tactics is designed for the self-protection of the correctional officers. It is a limited familiarization program of 10 hours, and all we can do is familiarize them with the techniques. We had originally requested that we'd be allowed to train in defensive tactics for 40 hours so that there would be more hands-on practical application of those exercises.
From here, this here is a straight-on block.
Training has been cut. Standards have been lowered. A year ago, the washout rate was 10%. It's down to 1%. Many of the trainees are out of shape, but if they're going to trim down and toughen up, they'll have to do it on their own time.
Let's say he has a shank. Did he say he slammed for what?
As long as they have never committed a felony, as long as they have not been convicted of a misdemeanor during the past 5 years, as long as they have graduated from high school or passed an equivalency exam, they are qualified to be trained as correctional officers in the state of Texas.
The correctional officer of today is entirely different, a totally different picture, a totally different person than the correctional officer of years gone by. But I feel that the desire within the person is still there. They may not possess all the skills, all the mechanics about it, all the technical qualities, but if the desire is there, we can do a lot with it.
Which is another way of saying, what else can we do? For a starting salary of $18,000 a year, almost any adult in Texas can work at a high-risk, high-tension job.
I come in every day thinking my life will be in danger. I really don't trust, you know, inmates. I feel that if you don't come in here thinking that your life's in danger, then the one day you don't think your life will be in danger, it is. It will be.
In 1996, there were 918 assaults on Texas correctional officers. In 1997, that number jumped by more than 50% to 1,442.
By the time I get home at night, I'm so wound up that it takes me 2-3 hours before I'm even able to think about going to bed.
It's a high-tension combination, verbal abuse and physical danger. We told you yesterday about correctional cocktails, mixtures of feces and urine that some inmates hurl at the correctional officers. In an age of AIDS, it's more than disgusting, it's unnerving.
You have to be really two different people, because if you go outside that gate and you act the same way you do in here, there's no one that's gonna wanna be around you. Because basically what you do all day is you tell people what to do. If you walk out this gate, and if I treated my fiance the way I treated, if I treated my fiance the way I treated the most well-behaved inmate, even, it wouldn't be a pretty sight. She wouldn't enjoy that at all.
It is hard not to feel a measure of compassion for men facing years of solitary confinement in a place where no shaft of natural light gives even a hint of the passage of time. You can even feel a grudging admiration for the spirit of inventiveness and determination that pries open the isolation of concrete and steel. But the same device that draws a newspaper or a magazine from cell to cell can also pass a shank or a razor blade. It can maintain discipline within the Aryan Brotherhood or the Mexican Mafia. It can also communicate an inmate's death sentence passed on by one prisoner to another. Never forget, this is a dangerous place, a tinderbox, and the explosions are set off by the tiniest sparks. Not a day goes by in the administrative segregation unit without an incident.
We're gonna need masks.
Little incidents usually, trivial incidents.
Any medical clearance to use chemical agents on inmate handy?
But violent men under stress are always considered dangerous and treated accordingly. There was a trivial incident the other day on cell block C.
Right now, as the situation was explained to me, the inmate refused to relinquish hand restraints, and he's out of one brace. He has the other brace still on his wrist, his other arm. And of course, you know, they're made out of metal, and that potentially could be a serious weapon.
Major William De La Rosa is the senior officer at the Estelle High Security Unit.
Right now, the officers are putting up a five-man team, and we're going to have a Lieutenant Henry supervising the whole incident. He's going to go up to the inmate cell. He's going to warn them of the consequences. He's going to tell them to submit to a strip search and to hand restraints. If the inmate fails to do that, chemical agents will be used.
Kevin Veselka will be the first officer to enter the cell.
So the day at the office.
You'll go in and you'll
do a physical after the use of force.
After the use of force. Will you have a gas mask on?
If they use gas.
Veselka, Keyes, Bridges, Wilkerson, Cox.
The third man in line, Officer Rayford Bridges, is the team leader.
When we're getting suited up to go in, I just want to lead the same way I came. I don't want nobody to go in that has to go into the cell with me coming out getting injured.
Well, usually dealing with that inmate before, usually just takes the gas from him. But every now and then he'll fight off the gas and wants to come in after him.
You got to be on your toes all the time. You just basically concentrate on what you're doing whenever you're in front of that cell door.
Officer Kimberly Driscoll is recording everything that happens on videotape.
The inmate, he was just acting abnormal. It's nothing new with that inmate. He just wanted attention.
This time, inmate is complying with orders from allowing.
We went to the cell, and the inmate, he complied to orders to have the hand restraints secured, so I secured the hand restraints. Once we've entered the cell and the inmate is subdued, placed on the floor, and when the leg restraints are secure, I let them know leg restraints secure. When the hand restraints are secure, I holler head, hand restraints secure. Anytime they have those restraints on, regardless if they're in behind his back or, you know, I've seen them bring them in the front. They can bring those handcuffs or hand restraints in front just as quick as you blink your eyes.
The inmate, as you all saw and witnessed, he complied. He gave us back the restraints, and no use force had to be used, so everything turned out well this time.
At first, when I first started doing this, it was kind of, I guess, scared, you know, but pretty soon you get used to it. It's a normal, everyday thing. You know, sometimes we'll wear this stuff for 2, 3, 4 hours, you know.
When you go in there, you have an adrenaline rush. Because when you go in, you don't know what the inmate's going to have, if he's going to have a homemade shank, anything like that. So you got to be prepared each time you go in, because you never know what to expect when you go in there. So you're always going to have an adrenaline high when you go in.
This incident was insignificant. But that is not always the way it goes. It's easy for resentment to build in a place like this. Small things loom large, and sometimes, even if you have a legitimate beef, nobody is inclined to listen. Sometimes inmates engage in pointless acts of rebellion.
Most people don't understand. By putting your arm out here and refusing to pull it back in again, they're going to come for you. So why are you doing it?
Because, Mr. Coppel, it's like this right here. For 8 days, I've been in a cell with no personal hygiene, no toothpaste, no shampoo, no deodorant, no nothing. Just for 8 days for something I ain't even done. And just, if you go to them and try to talk to them and let them know what the problem is, they just look the other way and just keep on going.
C-Wing is on lockdown because of something that happened 10 days ago. Since that time, the prisoners here have been kept in their cells 24 hours a day. The water turned on for just a few minutes at a time every couple of hours. There have been no hot meals, just bologna and peanut butter sandwiches for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And, like the man said, no toilet articles either.
You were here when they sprayed the gas the other day?
On the 16th, you wouldn't believe how many people, how close they come to killing people.
Some inmates say it started over the eggs. A couple of men thought they were entitled to 2 eggs for breakfast, and they were getting only one. Most everyone else seems to agree that it began when 12 prisoners were moved over here from D-Wing.
And in the process of moving these inmates over here, moving other inmates over, we shook down D-Wing, and we was in the process of shaking down C-Wing.
When you talk about shaking down the wing, you mean searching all the all the cells?
Yes, sir, searching the cells.
Right.
And looking for contraband. The inmates in C-Wing started creating a disturbance in the fact that they were beating and banging and kicking on their cell doors to where I felt like there was imminent property damage fixing to take place.
I mean, even in the short time I've been here, there's a lot of banging that goes on. I mean, there's a lot of frustration. That pounding the cell door seems to be, you know, one of the favorite activities around here. I mean, this is one of the few quiet moments we've had in the...
Oh, this is the banging that I'm talking about. I'm talking about kicking the light fixtures, trying to kick the light fixtures out, kicking the cell doors to where they're rocking off the track, and trying to cause destruction of property.
Not everybody on the wing was beating and banging on the door. It was nothing out of hand. At the most, it was 8 or 10 people beating and banging. Just about 3, maybe 4 people at the most.
In this situation, the warden had violated a procedure denying the prisoners an opportunity to have their property inventory in their presence. The prisoners protested.
These are all level 3 prisoners who are permitted very few privileges and very little personal property. So the ones who were moved here from D-Wing wanted to be sure that all their possessions had been brought over. At a time like that, do you even try to walk along the cell block and ask him or tell him to be quiet?
Yes, sir. You got to give the order to cease the behavior, and the behavior seemed to intensify.
They told no one to stop beating and banging.
I pulled the staff out off the wing. I notified my warden and explained the situation that was going on. He authorized me to use chemical agents.
As I come to my dooring area, I see approximately 6 cans of chemical agents lined on the one raw level down there. All of a sudden, I hear this sound like a bomb or something is about to go off.
It's a grenade, and when you throw it, it'll break into 3 different sections, and it'll administer 94 grams of gas.
I just see a cloud of fire, a cloud of smoke shooting into the air, dispersing chemical agent smoke, which is rising as gas is rising in the air.
Tear gas, it was strong. If there had been any individual over here with heart troubles, or asthmatic individual, there is no doubt in my mind there would have been a death.
Now, that's tear gas.
I wouldn't say tear gas. It's a eye irritant. Wouldn't call it tear gas in a form like the tear gas.
Although, if you're around that smoke,
yes, sir, it irritates the eyes.
Irritates
the
eyes.
Right.
It causes your eyes to tear up. It causes the mucus in your nose to start dripping out.
Yes.
Irritates the skin.
Right.
After that, we were stripped butt naked, handcuffed and shackled, and took to the recreation area and laid on the concrete.
We went along. After the grenades went off and we entered the wing, we started on one row, even side, on the end down here, and we started pulling inmates out. And while the officers were pulling inmates out, I walked the wing to make sure everybody was all right. And there were some inmates that it didn't have that big effect on. They were told me they was all right and they wasn't gonna, didn't need to go out.
The reason why I didn't let them take me out is because I had my property in the cell and they were confiscating property, or anybody that left out of the cell, they were taking all of the property. And if I would have exited my cell, they would have confiscated everything that I would have had. I would have came back in my cell naked.
Open your mouth, run your fingers through your hair, lift them.
So that's why for the past 10 days, C-Wing has been on lockdown. And why this man, whom you met at the beginning of the segment, refusing to pull his arm back through the food slot of his cell door, was protesting. He had nothing to do, he says, with the events that led to the gassing. But in administrative segregation, everything you do has consequences. Negotiation is not a part of the system here. You do what you're told, when you're told. This inmate, when they searched his cell, they found a single-edged razor blade and a fishing line. That, too, will have consequences. The state of Texas plans to spend hundreds of millions of dollars building new, specially designed high-security facilities, like this one adjoining the Estill prison near Huntsville, built to house the most dangerous and violent offenders. More than half the inmates at this prison within a prison are here because they are believed to be members of murderous prison gangs. It wasn't always like this. Prison gangs used to be segregated from the general population, but they were allowed to exercise together. This incident in 1985, captured on videotape by outnumbered guards, shows members of the Aryan Brotherhood gang turning on one of their own, stabbing him to death. Now, these gangs are isolated, cut off from nearly all contact with each other, and gang violence is down.
In here, you're a lot more enclosed. If you're not careful, you can go crazy. It's maximum security, right? Supposedly the most highest security of all the prisons. It's really difficult to speak to your neighbors here.
But even in here, communication is not impossible. Recreation time provides the opportunity for one-on-one contact between cages. The gangs have perfected elaborate hand signals to communicate.
No, I told you, I will give you my word. Okay?
Gang intelligence officers like Sergeant Irma Fernandez are assigned to every prison to monitor gang members, talking to informants, reading inmates' mail.
Just because they're in administrative segregation doesn't mean that they're isolated. You know, they still send word through visitation, you know, anything that they need done, through visitation, through the mail, coded letters. They can still, whatever they need, they can still get done.
Here's an example of a code. This is a postcard.
Sammy Buentello runs the war on gangs for the Texas prison system.
Basically, if you take off the photograph, you'll see that it's a number code. And in this particular case, they're discussing actually assaulting several people out in the community. And so this not only affects us, it affects the community at large. Just for example, this past weekend, we've had two homicides in San Antonio, Texas, one in Austin, Texas, and one in Dallas, Texas, that were related or suspected of being related to prison gang activity, and that's in just one weekend.
It's getting harder and harder to identify gang members as the prison authorities crack down on them. Tattoos with gang markings are increasingly camouflaged.
In this particular case, you see a camouflage Aryan Brotherhood. Now, if you look close underneath the eyes, you can see the A and the B.
We could identify them because they were marked. Okay, now they've gotten smarter because we have started locking, you know, a lot of them up now. So that makes it harder for us, and we did it through the correspondence. We searched their cells.
Selling contraband, you know, selling things, you know, extortion.
This man is a member of the Hispanic gang Barrio Aztecas, doing time in administrative segregation.
All my time I've been back here.
The rest of your time?
The rest of my time I'll be back here. And each time I keep coming back to prison, I'm gonna be back here.
How does a little guy handle himself in a place like this? By himself.
Even small people need to learn to maintain their own respect amongst others, especially in prison. If I have to go as far as using some kind of weapon to defend myself, or if I have to go as far as putting myself on the line to maintain my respect, then that's what I'm going to do.
This is a place where they test you, though, isn't it?
Yes. I'm going to do whatever it takes to survive while I'm in this place.
The reason I joined was because while you're in here, you know, you're not going to be able to do your time by yourself. Physically, you could do your time. I could do my time physically. Mentally is what you need support in, not only with your family, but with other people. What we're about is it's brothers. We're brothers, which is we help each other out financially, mentally, you know, physically.
If someone wanted to opt out, if someone said, I've had enough, I don't want to be a part of the gang, I want to leave, you can't just resign your membership.
No, sir, you cannot. Blood in, blood out. That's what this is all about.
I really can't go into it, you know, the details. But, no, you can't just say my membership has expired and I'm just gonna walk away. It doesn't work like that.
And if you tried to do that,
well,
there are consequences.
There's consequences for everything. Unfortunately, the consequences on my situation, well, they're pretty bad. I'll just put it to you like that.
You ever thought about quitting the gang?
No.
Why?
Because there's a lot of consequences. The consequences is death. I don't want to die.
Discipline is the hallmark of the prison gangs, but what terrorizes their enemies also keeps their own membership in line. At this cell block, where members of the Mexican Mafia are held in administrative segregation, this is the quietest, best-behaved unit in the prison. K Block, a still prison high-security unit. There is no angry yelling or banging on doors here. This is home to the Mexican Emmy, the Mexican Mafia. With more than 1,500 members in Texas prisons alone, they are considered the largest prison gang in the country and one of the most violent, specializing in drug dealing and contract assassinations. I talked with members of the gang in their cells on K Block.
This is the most well-behaved cell block on the unit. And the main reason is that we discipline ourselves. We try to emphasize to all our members to have respect for the officers, because that'll minimize problems for us and for them. We just want to do our time.
Joe Saldivar is a member of the gang who has been in administrative segregation for 16 years.
Now, you're in here, those of you who are members of the Mexican Emmy.
are in here not because you have assaulted a guard or not necessarily because of any violence while you were in prison population, but simply because you are members of a prison gang.
Anybody who was known or suspected of being a gang member was segregated. But for the last 4 or 5 years, all our leaders have been engaged in is nothing more than establishing peaceful relations with everybody in prison.
But the fact of the matter is, you men are a family. You are not only loyal to one another because you want to be, there are times when you are loyal to one another because the consequences of disloyalty, I mean, I've read your constitution, the consequences of disloyalty are death.
Theoretically.
I'd be a dead man.
They're supposed to be dead men, but there's cell blocks full of exes, not only from our family, but from other families. And it's practically impossible to carry out a murder the way you contemplate.
Yeah, so maybe one day I'll be out on the street again. I mean, people have long memories, right?
That's happening. I can't deny that.
You've been in here how many years?
About 17 years.
17 years in prison. How many years in ADSEG?
About 16.
Explain to me, I mean, you're a very eloquent and apparently a well-read man. Explain to me how a man survives that and keeps his sanity, as you clearly have.
Well, I just keep my mind occupied on whatever I paint, I draw, I write, I read, and I exercise and I keep active. I'm 55 years old and I try to keep in shape.
Are you in for life?
I've got a life sentence. And I'm trying to make parole.
Nobody seems to make parole here.
No, there's no more parole in Texas. And I don't know, I guess I'm stuck in here.
Yeah, I've run into several men like you here, Joe, who are clearly very intelligent men, who have the self-discipline to teach themselves something that on the outside you would have had to go to law school to learn. And I guess the sad question is, why the hell didn't you do it when you were on the outside and when you had the chance to do it?
I guess if we had that answer, we wouldn't be here. I don't understand it myself. I don't know it.
I mean, just think, if you'd gone to law school, you could be on the outside helping get other young men out of here, right?
Yes, sir.
One young man on cell block K who may see the outside of prison before growing old is Speedy Garza, up for a parole hearing in June and general release in the year 2001. Your family was here a few days ago to visit you.
Yes.
Does that make it easier or harder when you've seen the family?
Well, it's really hard. I can't show that I'm afraid or that I'm scared or that I miss them or that I'm tired of being in this place. I can't show very many emotions at that time. I have to try and be strong so that they can be strong. So I try my best to keep a smile on my face and make them think that, well, everything is okay.
While Speedy Garza meets with his family, nearby, a mother meets with her son. He has joined the Ku Klux Klan since coming to prison.
All you gotta do, go to the FBI and they'll show you who's the ones killing the people, raping the babies out there, selling the crack cocaine on the streets, robbery, carjacking. They sure ain't the white people.
Travis Poole is doing 20 years for two counts of burglary. He is 27 years old, an avowed racist, and a proud member of the KKK. He is kept in total isolation, confined to his windowless cell for 23 hours a day.
Good morning, may I help you?
Visitor Virginia Poole.
He's Virginia Poole's only son. She and her husband raised Travis in a Dallas suburb where he got hooked on drugs, was in juvenile detention at age 14, in prison at 18.
A long time ago, I made up my mind. I love my child unconditionally, and I apologize to no one for loving my child. I'm not ashamed of him. I'm ashamed of some of the things he has done, though. I will be by him as long as I'm alive and he needs me.
Visiting days for most prisoners means hugs and kisses. For a prisoner under segregation, it means no human contact, ever.
How's it going?
Hey, babe.
Yeah.
I cannot describe how it feels. A mother likes to touch her children even when they're grown. I've touched him one time in almost 5 years, and it hurts. Hurts a lot.
They talk about hatred, about his membership in the Klan. She and her husband raised their son to respect all races.
Some of the things that I tell him is not real nice about it. Some of the words I say to him about that's very harsh.
Very harsh.
She tells him to keep his hatreds to himself.
And I hate it. And I ask him not to tell that. I'm very ashamed of that. I'm very ashamed of that.
Where does that come from?
It does not come from me or his father. It comes from prison.
So you got in here because of drugs and burglary. And,
yes, sir.
How'd you end up in ANSEC?
Well, I had a couple of fights, inmate assault, and weapon possession. You know, when you first come in, you get attacked. You see, if you're a man, they call it checking. You're gonna fight. You don't get jumped on by one inmate. You get jumped on by four or five. Right. And after you fight one group of racists, you fight the other ones.
But you're in here then because you were in fights a lot?
I've had a few fights. I had about four fights and stuff like that, and four weapons possession.
So what does the Klan do for you in a place like this?
Well, they write letters, they call the warden. They come up here when their members are having problems, stuff like that.
So you communicate with them the way you communicate with your family?
No, so it's on a different level. My parents and my family are not racist, quote, racist, and they're against my beliefs. My mom don't even talk to me about it. She tells me I'm a fool. You know, she hates it. She don't believe in it.
So why do you do it?
Well, I believe in it now. I believe in it.
Well, I'm still a little confused as to what it is that made you. I mean, you say
they was carrying somebody there.
Well, if I understand you right, you say you don't hate black people, you don't hate Jews, you don't hate Mexicans, right?
That's right.
So is it a question of racial superiority? Is it a question of one race being better than another?
No. Well, God put everybody on earth for a purpose, and we all got our place in time. And I feel we were the best ones. The white people are the best ones.
White Christians?
Yes, sir, white Christians.
There's a lot of black inmates on this cell block.
Yes, there is. Yeah. That's why I think they moved me over here.
Now, does that bother you, being on a cell block with a lot of African-Americans?
I'd rather be around white supremacists if you
had your choice.
Yes, sir.
Well, we talked to your mom after she came to the visit, and she does disapprove. I mean,
yes, sir. She don't like it.
She doesn't think you're on the right track there.
No, she don't.
I mean, I get the feeling that you and your mom are pretty close, right?
Yeah. I love her with all my heart, but, you know, she's been here for me. I've done a lot. My family shouldn't even be there for me because I've done a lot to them and stuff like that. But they've been there for me.
I think society as a whole views our prison population as worthless, and they're really not. I believe in justice. I'm not opposed to the death penalty. And it causes a lot of mixed emotions inside a mother's heart.
You got this? You see this? It's all about that, America. It's all about that, America. Recognize it. Recognize it. That we ain't going nowhere. 33-5. Genocide! We are the master race!
My child shouldn't be living in this. No mother's child should be living in this. But, however, we have to have justice in our society. And we're not against justice. But sometimes, instead of our system making better people out of them, it makes them worse. And that hurts. And everybody loses. Everybody loses.
These administrative segregation units, in some states they're called supermax prisons, are clean, high-tech, state-of-the-art, and very, very tough to take.
When I got here in this prison, it's nothing like the other prisons.
Speedy Garza is in prison on two counts of burglary. He's here in administrative segregation because prison officials identify him as a member of the Mexican Mafia, the largest and most violent prison gang in America.
Forward! Move!
Supermax units were designed in the first place because prison gangs were quite literally at war with one another. Prison officials couldn't contain the violence. So now, if you're identified as a prison gang member, you're automatically assigned to one of these ADSEG units. These places are about behavior modification, and sensory deprivation is part of the plan. Harvard psychiatrist Dr. Stuart Grassian has studied the effects of solitary confinement on prisoners around the country.
They start seeing the walls of their cells moving in and out, lights getting brighter and duller. They start seeing spots, and then the spots become meaningful stimulation, hallucinations. So over time, people lose their capacity to know what's going on inside of their heads and what's going on outside.
When I got here, I realized there's no windows, there aren't anything. It's a lot more difficult. It was a lot different from what I was in, from what I was used to.
They become increasingly anxious, paranoid, and overtly confused, delirious, and psychotic.
If you're not careful, you can go crazy. There's already been three individuals whom I know of personally that got here pretty sane. They were doing all right. And, unfortunately, they're not the same anymore.
What are you here for?
Texas State Senator John Whitmire was in the forefront of the Get Tough with Criminals movement.
We have the toughest penal code in the United States. It's expensive, it's unfortunate, but what do you do when you have individuals that just insist on violating the law? They don't want to get along, they want to hurt people, they want to hurt guards, they want to hurt other inmates. This is our first, this is a prototype. We're building several others. And the question ought to be, where do they go from here?
Actually, the crime that gets you sentenced to prison in the first place has nothing to do with whether you spend time in administrative segregation.
Stick it out a little bit further, Davis.
Some of the most violent criminals are model prisoners, while some of the men convicted of lesser charges, like burglary or selling marijuana or driving while intoxicated, end up here because they resorted to violence for one reason or another in the general prison population. And once they're here, whatever got them here, they have to deal with solitary. And a lot of men can't.
I mean, he strikes me as being a little psychotic, is he?
He strikes me that way too, yes, sir. Some days he's on, some days he's off.
I've seen people just completely have lost their mind in sitting, or completely crazy. Talk to themselves, they play with their own waste. You know, they just, those type of people, you know, I really can't say what they do when they get out. They can't conduct themselves in here, so I doubt they can conduct themselves when they get in the streets.
95% of these individuals will be out on the streets again. That's the statistic. That's how many get out. And when you house them in these settings, you're costing us as much money as you possibly can. This is the most expensive way to house a prisoner. So you're going to ultimately get prisoners out sooner, and you're going to get them back to our community in the most violent and crazed and disordered state that you can possibly have them in.
A still prison psychologist, Dan Busby, disagrees.
Sometimes it has absolutely no effect. It's absolutely nothing to them. Then other people will have some effect from the deprivation of stimulus. But I find that's a very small percentage.
I have the Spirit of God in me. That's right. I'm the Son of God.
The percentage may be in dispute, but there is general agreement that this place drives men mad.
Yeah, it really do. If you, like, it got several guys on this wing that went nuts.
The people, some of the people behind those is crazy, but me, how I feel,
lost, lonely. I cried a lot.
We have learned, we now believe, how to build the prison of the future. It may be a few more years before we can accurately gauge the full measure of what we've achieved. Solitude is a precious thing, but only when it's a matter of choice. In this place, you're left with very few choices. Here, solitude is the constant reality that governs your life and tests your endurance. Your cell is a little more than 7 feet wide, and if you include the width of your bunk, it's about 11 feet long. We installed two tiny wide-angle cameras in the cell, and I brought in a Hi-8 camera that would permit me to keep sort of a video diary. You can't expect to reproduce the desperation that must come with knowing that you're going to be locked in a cell like this for the indefinite future, but the hope was that if I spent 12 or 14 hours here, I might gain a useful insight or two. I was put on C wing. This is the cell block they gassed a couple of weeks back. Almost all the inmates here are level 3, which is to say they have very few privileges to begin with. Since the incident that provoked the gassing, they have no privileges. The entire cell block is on lockdown.
Hard to know where to begin. The noise, or was this the first time? They locked me in here about 8:30, and about 8:40, the banging started. One of the inmates a few cells down, just banging on his door, banging on his door.
The microphones on these Hi-8 cameras are not too good. The steel and concrete makes the cells kind of echoey to begin with, and the noise, even without the banging, rarely lets up.
Since that time, just a lot of yelling. Some of it, I'm sure, is yelling back and forth, cell to cell, people communicating with one another, but a lot of it is just yelling, just people giving vent to their frustration, their anger, their madness, whatever it happens to be.
Normally, if that's ever an appropriate word in this place, normally, meals must be an important break in the monotony. Since the lockdown went into effect, they're part of it.
Had my first Johnny, my first sandwich, peanut butter and jelly. Not the best peanut butter, not the best jelly, but hamburgers. Still, the notion of having peanut butter and jelly 3 times a day, they've had it now for 10 days.
The theory of behavior modification in this place is as simple as it gets. Good behavior is rewarded, bad behavior is always punished. Food is an instrument of reward or punishment.
The knowledge that people can walk by this cell, if they're so inclined, if for one reason or another they want to punish the person in here and forget about breakfast, or forget about lunch, or maybe forget about all 3 meals in a day.
Water is normally turned on to the in-cell showers for 20 to 30 minutes a day. It can also be turned off. If a family member puts money into a prisoner's account, he can buy a few items from the commissary, even a radio with a headset. But radios are a privilege not available to prisoners on level 3. So there are no radios in this wing.
The noise is bad. I don't know if you can hear it, but there's just a lot of shouting. And I guess the ear adjusts to that kind of thing over a period of time. But for the most part, I can't understand what anybody says. For the most part, it seems like whining.
Prisoners who are evaluated as being psychotic are sent to special psychiatric units in other parts of the state, but they're also sent back. Several of them are on this wing now. It's a close call, and it's hard to see how this place will do anything but drive them over the line again.
I thought the nights would be the bad part here. I don't think that anymore. I've been here long enough at least to know that no matter what the noise is out there, you can sleep. And as long as you're sleeping, the hours pass very quickly. But the daytime, when you sit here sort of wondering how you're going to fill the day, that's going to be really difficult in this place.
There's a guy on the other side of the cell block indicating that he wants to send me a letter. The technique is called getting online, or fishing. He's flicking out a line weighted with a comb. If I had a line of my own, I'd be expected to hook his with mine, and then I could draw his line with the letter into my cell. This guy is good enough, though, to do it without any help from me.
There's the fishing line, and somehow that inmate across the hall managed to flick that comb under the door of his cell, across the floor of the corridor between our two cells, under the door of my cell.
The letter was mostly about food. Says he's not getting enough, that he weighed 138 pounds at the beginning of January and is now down to 122. Nobody promised us a rose garden, he writes. On the same token, someone did promise us the rights of being human. He gets the letter to me just about the time my brief stay in ADSEG is over. He's happy, though, believing that I will get the news out to you. But if he thinks that most Americans will care, he has probably misread the public mood. It doesn't matter whether an inmate is a murderer or the writer of bad checks. Here in Texas, generally all inmates begin their sentences in the general population. But it is behavior that determines whether an inmate stays there or whether he must be segregated here in this prison within a prison. I sat down with the warden here at the Estelle unit and with the director of the Texas Department of Criminal Justice, Wayne Scott.
Psychologically, boy, you talk about deprivation. You don't see daylight. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe two or three times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking at about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision for that reason. Because if we think somebody is a continuing danger to society, we want to do everything possible within our means to track that individual, to keep them from creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical professionals in there three or four times a week talking to those people. We don't want somebody to become fully psychotic, and before, if we can catch them early on and get them shipped out for treatment, and that's why we try to keep such a close eye on that.
Little psychosis is okay. Huh?
All of us have it.
We talked to a Harvard psychiatrist who specializes in solitary confinement. What he talks about is acute sensory deprivation. That's the most difficult part.
I can understand where the isolation could affect an individual's mind, but again, they chose to be there. We did not put them there. They chose to be there.
Look, this is a place where everything you do has consequences.
Yes, sir.
This is also a place filled with people who didn't get that when they were outside in the world. They always thought the consequences didn't apply to that. So the question is, how well did the teaching methods work?
It's obvious that they're not working. And again, that goes back to the individual, what he wants to take in and what he does with that information when he gets there.
The great fear, I think, that people on the outside may have, I'm talking about civilians, when they see the series that we've been doing. Is the implicit message here is you've got men who are so incorrigible, so tough, so violent, that they can't make it here in the general prison population where they're surrounded by people just like them. But once they've done their time in Ed Say, they're out on the street. I'd be a little concerned if one of those fellows was moving into my neighborhood, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes, sir, I'd be concerned.
And what's the answer?
There's no hope for that individual, in my opinion. He was aggressive, for one, to get into Ed Say, and he was probably aggressive before he came to the penitentiary, and he's going to continue to be aggressive when he gets out.
But if anything, he's a little meaner, a little tougher, a little more psychotic than he was when he got here in the first place.
Yes, sir, I'm not going to argue that point either.
You're the mayor of a big and tough city here, and you've got to take control of this place and maintain control of this place. But let me ask you to put your warden's hat aside for a moment. Just talk to me now as citizen figure. Is there a better way that society can deal with these men before they come in here?
I think we're not educating at the elementary grades. And when I say that, we're not educating as far as what's right and wrong. Some people accept that, you know, if you do something wrong, and if I try to approach that child and try to correct him, I have to worry about the mother and the father and everyone else. And I think that's where I see some mistakes being made.
Lack of discipline.
Yes, sir, lack of discipline from the parenting into
prison gang.
Anybody who was known or suspected of being a gang member was segregated. But for the last 4 or 5 years, all our leaders have been engaged in is nothing more than establishing peaceful relations with everybody in prison.
But the fact of the matter is, you men are a family. You are not only loyal to one another because you want to be, there are times when you are loyal to one another because the consequences of disloyalty, I mean, I've read your constitution, the consequences of disloyalty are death.
Theoretically.
I'd be a dead man.
They're supposed to be dead men, but there's cell blocks full of exes, not only from our family, but from other families. And it's practically impossible to carry out a murder the way you contemplate.
Yeah, so maybe one day I'll be out on the street again. I mean, people have long memories, right?
That's happening. I can't deny that.
You've been in here how many years?
About 17 years.
17 years in prison. How many years in Ed Say?
About 16.
Explain to me, I mean, you're a very eloquent and apparently a well-read man. Explain to me how a man survives that and keeps his sanity, as you clearly have.
Well, I just keep my mind occupied on whatever I paint, I draw, I write, I read, and I exercise and I keep active. I'm 55 years old and I try to keep in shape.
Are you in for life?
I've got a life sentence. I'm trying to make parole.
Nobody seems to make parole these days.
No, there's no more parole in Texas. And I don't know, I guess I'm stuck in here.
Yeah, I've run into several men like you here, Joe, who are clearly very intelligent men, who have the self-discipline to teach themselves something that on the outside you would have had to go to law school to learn. And I guess the sad question is, why the hell didn't you do it when you were on the outside and when you had the chance to do it?
I guess if we had that answer, we wouldn't be here. I don't understand it myself. I don't know it.
I mean, just think, if you'd gone to law school, you could be on the outside helping get other young men out of here, right?
Yes, sir.
One young man on cell block K who may see the outside of prison before growing old is Speedy Garza, up for a parole hearing in June, and general release in the year 2001.
Your family was here a few days ago to visit you.
Yes.
Does that make it easier?
Mark, don't come here. It ain't no place to be.
Willie, when he came in, of course, I've already been informed that and prepared that he was giving them problems in the main building, and in this case, it was a strip search. So I'm perceiving a problem.
You have two staff assaults. Your latest one was on 7/10 of 97, which was striking nostril. I'm going to remain you a level 3, starting off here, and in the next 30 days, we'll reevaluate you again.
And they had already made their decision. They were just going through the formalities. And, you know, I felt like I was being treated like, you know, like livestock or something.
He's got a stand-up posture. I see Willie doing exactly what he wants to do, or he thinks what he wants to do. I told Willie, I don't see you having any problem over here as long as you do what's mandated. Do you have a problem with that? And his answer was no, sir.
This also created a whole lot of, you know, mental problems. I would be willing to believe of half the people over here on some kind of psych medication. Being locked up in these cells 23, 24 hours, 7 days a week, most people break after a year or two. Most people break.
Yesterday, when I went to Willie Madlock's cell in cell block C, we talked for almost half an hour.
I gotta ask you, Willie, you could play the game, right?
Right.
You could play by the rules. You could right. say, all right, I'm gonna keep my nose clean and I'm gonna try and make it out of here.
Right.
I don't get the sense that's the way you're made, though. I mean, you look upon this as kind of a challenge. I mean, I've got to say, I have sort of grudging admiration for you, yeah. but you know, there's an easy way and there's a hard way.
If you lose control over yourself, you'll never get it back. I mean, it's easier to be on the outside looking in and, you know, judging, you know, it's like this here.
Place.
The reason I joined was because while you're in here, you know, you're not going to be able to do your time by yourself. Physically, you could do your time. I could do my time physically. Mentally is what you need support in, not only with your family, but with other people. What we're about is we're brothers, which is we help each other out financially, mentally, you know, physically.
If someone wanted to opt out, if someone said, I've had enough, I don't want to be a part of the gang, I want to leave. You can't just resign your membership.
No, sir, you cannot. Blood in, blood out. That's what this is all about.
I really can't go into it, you know, the details. But, no, you can't just say my membership has expired and I'm just gonna walk away. It doesn't work like that.
And if you're trying to do that? There are consequences.
There's consequences for everything. Unfortunately, the consequences on my situation, well, they're pretty bad. I'll just put it to you like that.
You ever thought about quitting the gang?
No.
Why?
Because there's a lot of consequences. The consequences is death. I don't want to die.
Discipline is the hallmark of the prison gangs, but what terrorizes their enemies also keeps their own membership in line. At this cell block, where members of the Mexican Mafia are held in administrative segregation, This is the quietest, best-behaved unit in the prison.
K Block, a still prison high-security unit. There is no angry yelling or banging on doors here. This is home to the Mexican Emmy, the Mexican Mafia. With more than 1,500 members in Texas prisons alone, they are considered the largest prison gang in the country and one of the most violent, specializing in drug dealing and contract assassinations. I talked with members of the gang in their cells on K Block.
This is the most well-behaved cell block on the unit. And the main reason is that we discipline ourselves. We try to emphasize to all our members to have respect for the officers, because that'll minimize problems for us and for them. We just want to do our time.
Joe Saldivar is a member of the gang who has been in administrative segregation for 16 years.
Now, you're in here, those of you who are members of...
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting as far as day and night, and I'm not sure of days. It's been numerous days, I would say weeks, maybe even a couple of months.
But now we're supposed to be functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor, but this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. ADSEG at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact. And you can see the sky.
You got eight?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others. But then, too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the ADSEG unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, your mouth, foot, turn around, left foot, right foot, bend over, spread your cheeks.
Everything went SOP, standing.
I want to leave the same way I came. I don't want nobody that's go in, that has to go into the cell with me, coming out getting injured.
Well, usually dealing with that inmate before, usually just takes the gas with him. But every now and then he'll fight off the gas and wants to come in after him.
You got to be on your toes all the time. You just basically concentrate on what you're doing whenever you're in front of that cell door.
Officer Kimberly Driscoll is recording everything that happens on videotape.
The inmate, he was just acting abnormal. It's nothing new with that inmate. He just wanted attention.
This time, inmate is complying with orders.
We went to the cell, and the inmate, he complied to orders to have the hand restraints secured, so I secured the hand restraints. Once we've entered the cell and the inmate is subdued, placed on the floor, and when the leg restraints are secure, I let them know leg restraints secure. When the hand restraints are secure, I holler hand restraints secure. Anytime they have those restraints on, regardless if they're in behind his back or, you know, I've seen them bring them in the front. They can bring those handcuffs or hand restraints in front just as quick as you blink your eyes.
The inmate, as you all saw and witnessed, he complied. He gave us back the restraints and no use force had to be used, so everything turned out well this time.
At first started doing this, it was kind of, I guess, scared, you know, but pretty soon you get used to it. It's a normal everyday thing. You know, sometimes we'll wear this stuff for 2, 3, 4 hours, you know.
When you go in there, you have an adrenaline rush, because when you go in, you don't know what the inmate's going to have, if he's going to have a homemade shank, anything like that. So you got to be prepared each time you go in, because you never know what to expect when you go in there. So you're always going to have an adrenaline high when you go in.
This incident was insignificant, but that is not always the way it goes. It's easy for resentment to build in a place like this. Small things loom large, and sometimes, even if you have a legitimate beef, nobody is inclined to listen. Sometimes inmates engage in pointless acts of rebellion.
Most people don't understand. By putting your arm out here and refusing to pull it back in again, they're going to come for you. So why are you doing it?
Because, Miss Coppola, it's like this right here.
Is now down to 122. Nobody promised us a rose garden, he writes. On the same token, someone did promise us the rights of being human. He gets the letter to me just about the time my brief stay in ADSEG is over. He's happy, though, believing that I will get the news out to you. But if he thinks that most Americans will care, he has probably misread the public mood. It doesn't matter whether an inmate is a murderer or the writer of bad checks. Here in Texas, generally all inmates begin their sentences in the general population. But it is behavior that determines whether an inmate stays there or whether he must be segregated here in this prison within a prison. I sat down with the warden here at the Estelle unit and with the director of the Texas Department of Criminal Justice, Wayne Scott.
Psychologically, boy, you talk about deprivation. You don't see daylight. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe 2 or 3 times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision. For that reason, because if we think somebody is a continuing danger to society, we want to do everything possible within our means to track that individual, to keep them from creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical professionals in there 3 or 4 times a week talking to those people. We don't want somebody to become fully psychotic, and if we can catch them early on and get them shipped out for treatment, and that's why we try to keep such a close eye on that.
Little psychosis is okay. Huh?
All of us have it.
We talked to
Harvard psychiatrist who specializes in solitary confinement. What he talks about is acute sensory deprivation, that's the most difficult part.
I can understand what, you know, where the isolation.
Their clothing is examined. Then, before they're taken out of their cells, the inmates are handcuffed. Two guards escort each man down the hall behind a rolling shield that protects them from assault by other inmates. Otherwise, the only breaks in the day come at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting as far as day and night, and I'm not sure of days. It's been numerous days, I would say weeks, maybe even a couple of months.
And now we're supposed to be functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor, but this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. ANSAG at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact, and you can see the sky.
You got eight?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say,
creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical professionals in there three or four times a week talking to those people. We don't want somebody to become fully psychotic, and before, if we can catch them early on and get them shipped out for treatment, and that's why we try to keep such a close eye on that.
Little psychosis is okay, huh?
All of us have it.
We talked to Harvard psychiatrist who specializes in solitary confinement. What he talks about is acute sensory deprivation. That's the most difficult part.
I can understand what, you know, where the isolation could affect an individual's mind. But again, they chose to be there. We did not put them there. They chose to be there.
Look, this is a place where everything you do has consequences. This is also a place filled with people who didn't get that when they were outside in the world. They always thought the consequences didn't apply to that. So the question is, how well did the teaching methods work?
It's obvious that they're not working. And again, that goes back to the individual, what he wants to take in and what he does with that information when he gets it.
The great fear, I think, that people on the outside may have, talking about civilians, when they see the series that we've been doing, is the implicit message here is you've got men who are so incorrigible, so tough, so violent, that they can't make it here in the general prison population where they're surrounded by people just like them. But once they've done their time in Ad Sed, they're out on the street. I'd be a little concerned if one of those fellows was moving into my neighborhood, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes, sir, I'd be concerned.
And what's the answer?
There's no hope for that individual, in my opinion. He was aggressive, for one, to get into Ad Sed, and he was probably aggressive before he came to the penitentiary, and he's going to continue to be aggressive when he gets out.
But if anything, he's a little meaner, a little tougher, a little more psychotic than he was when he got here in the first place.
Yes, sir, I'm not going to argue that point either.
You're the mayor of a big and tough city here, and you've got to take control of this place and maintain control of this place. But let me ask you to put your warden's hat aside for a moment. Just talk to me now as citizen Figueroa.
I'm at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting as far as day and night, and I'm not sure of days. It's been numerous days, I would say weeks, maybe even a couple of months.
But now we're supposed to be functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor, but this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. Ad Sed at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact. And you can see the sky.
You got 8?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others. But then, too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the Ad Sed unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David, as long as they have never committed a felony, as long as they have not been convicted of a misdemeanor during the past 5 years, as long as they have graduated from high school or passed an equivalency exam, they are qualified to be trained as correctional officers in the state of Texas.
The correctional officer of today is entirely different, a totally different picture, a totally different person than the correctional officer of years gone by. But I feel that the desire within the person is still there. They may not possess all the skills, all the mechanics about it, all the technical qualities, but if the desire is there, we can do a lot with it.
Which is another way of saying, what else can we do? For a starting salary of $18,000 a year, almost any adult in Texas can work at a high-risk, high-tension job.
I come in every day thinking my life will be in danger. I really don't trust, you know, inmates. I feel that if you don't come in here thinking that your life's in danger, then the one day you don't think your life will be in danger, it is. It will be.
In 1996, there were 918 assaults on Texas correctional officers. In 1997, that number jumped by more than 50% to 1,442.
By the time I get home at night, I'm so wound up that it takes me 2-3 hours before I'm even able to think about going to bed.
It's a high-tension combination, verbal abuse and physical danger. We told you yesterday about correctional cocktails, mixtures of feces and urine that some inmates hurl at the correctional officers. In an age of AIDS, it's more than disgusting, it's unnerving.
You have to be really two different people, because if you go outside that gate and you act the same way you're doing here, there's no one that's going to want to be around you. Because basically what you do all day is you tell people what to do. If you walk out this gate, and if I treated my fiance the way I treated, if I treated my fiance the way I treated the most well-behaved inmate, it wouldn't be a pretty sight. She wouldn't enjoy that at all.
It is hard not to feel a measure of compassion for men facing years of solitary confinement in a place where no shaft of natural light gives even a hint of the passage of time. You can even feel a grudging admiration for the spirit of inventiveness and determination that pries open the isolation of concrete and steel. But the same device that draws a newspaper or a magazine from cell to cell can also pass a shank or a razor blade. It can maintain discipline within the Aryan Brotherhood or the Mexican Mafia. It can also communicate an inmate's death sentence passed on by one prisoner to another.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting as far as day and night, and I'm not sure of days. It's been numerous days, I would say weeks, maybe even a couple of months.
But now we're supposed to be functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor, but this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. ADSEG at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact, and you can see the sky.
You got 8?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others, but then too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the ADSEG unit. two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, your mouth, flip, turn around,
It's your aim to white people.
Travis Poole is doing 20 years for two counts of burglary. He is 27 years old, an avowed racist, and a proud member of the KKK. He is kept in total isolation, confined to his windowless cell for 23 hours a day.
Good morning, may I help you?
Visitor Virginia Poole.
He's Virginia Poole's only son. She and her husband raised Travis in a Dallas suburb where he got hooked on drugs, was in juvenile detention at age 14, in prison at 18.
A long time ago, I made up my mind. I love my child unconditionally, and I apologize to no one for loving my child. I'm not ashamed of him. I'm ashamed of some of the things he has done, though. I will be by him as long as I'm alive and he needs me.
Visiting days for most prisoners means hugs and kisses. For a prisoner under segregation, it means no human contact, ever.
How's it going?
Hey, babe.
Yeah.
I cannot describe how it feels. A mother likes to touch her children even when they're grown. I've touched him one time in almost 5 years, and it hurts. Hurts a lot.
They talk about hatred, about his membership in the Klan. She and her husband raised their son to respect all races.
Some of the things that I tell him is not real nice about it. Some of the words I say to him about that's very harsh, very harsh.
She tells him to keep his hatreds to himself.
And I hate it, and I ask him not to tell that. I'm very ashamed of that. I'm very ashamed of that.
Where does that come from?
It does not come from me or his father. It comes from prison.
So you got in here because of drugs and burglary, and
yes, sir.
How'd you end up in ANSEC?
Well, I had a couple of fights, inmate assault, and weapon possession. You know, when you first come in, you get attacked. You see, if you're a man, they call it checking. You're gonna fight. You don't get jumped on by one inmate. You get jumped on by four or five.
Right.
And after you fight one group of racists, you fight the other ones.
But you're in here then because you were in fights a lot?
I've had a few fights. I had about four fights and stuff like that, and four weapons possession.
So what does the Klan do for you in a place like this?
Well, they write letters. They call the warden. They come up here when their members are having problems, stuff like that.
So you communicate with them the way you communicate?
You'll see that it's a number code. And in this particular case, they're discussing actually assaulting several people out in the community. And so this not only affects us, it affects the community at large. Just for example, this past weekend, we've had two homicides in San Antonio, Texas, one in Austin, Texas, and one in Dallas, Texas that were related or suspected of being related to prison gang activity, and that's in just one weekend.
It's getting harder and harder to identify gang members as the prison authorities crack down on them. Tattoos with gang markings are increasingly camouflaged.
In this particular case, you see a camouflaged Aryan Brotherhood. Now, if you look close underneath the eyes, you can see the A and the B.
We could identify them because they were marked. Okay, now they've gotten smarter because we have started locking, you know, a lot of them up now. So that makes it harder for us, and we did it through their correspondence. We searched their cells.
Selling contraband, you know, selling things, you know, extortion.
This man is a member of the Hispanic gang Barrio Aztecas, doing time in administrative segregation.
All my time I've been back here.
The rest of your time?
The rest of my time I'll be back here. And each time I keep coming back to prison, I'm gonna be back here.
How does a little guy handle himself in a place like this?
See,
by himself?
Even small people need to learn to maintain their own respect amongst others, especially in prison. If I have to go as far as
using some kind of weapon to defend myself. Or if I have to go as far as putting myself on the line to maintain my respect, then now that's what I'm gonna do.
This is a place where they test you though, isn't it?
Yes. I'm gonna do whatever it takes to survive while I'm in this place.
The reason I joined was because while you're in here, you know, you're not gonna be able to do your time by yourself. Physically, you could do your time. I could do my time physically. Mentally is what you need support in, not only with your family, but with other people. What we're about is brothers. We're brothers, which is we help each other out financially, mentally, you know, physically.
If someone wanted to opt out, if someone said, I've had enough, I don't want to be a part of the gang, I want to leave, you can't just resign your membership.
No, sir, you cannot. Blood in, blood out. That's what this is all about.
I really can't go into it, you know, the details. But, no, you can't just say my membership has expired and I'm just gonna...
Functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor. But this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. Ad Seg at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact, and you can see the sky.
You got eight?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others, but then too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the Ad Seg unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, your mouth, foot, turn around, lift your left foot, right foot, bend over, spread your cheeks.
Everything went SOP, standard operating procedures. I've known him quite some time through his incarceration.
Barker is going to Ad Seg for assaulting a guard, but assaulting a guard can be as simple as a verbal threat.
He's a very passive individual. He's also a manipulator by bad behavior. He might stand his own for a while until he decided to go the easy way out and maybe do a staff assault and get locked up.
Every time we leave, they strip us to make sure we don't got nothing. I'm used to it now. Happens. Every time we come out, gotta get used to it.
The second prisoner awaiting transfer, Willie Madlock.
Mr. Madlock, you're going over to administrative segregation, is that correct?
Right.
Have you been over there before?
No.
You know what it's like?
No. No.
You have any idea?
No.
Everything was going fantastic. Just standard operating procedures. He got out of all his...
Last 7 years. And doing time has grown harder.
It seems like they're trying to provoke people now, you know, like little stuff like, I don't know, man, it's always they're taking things and they're not giving nothing.
Good, say the taxpayers. Exactly what we wanted, say the voters. But there's always a price. With fewer incentives for good behavior, there was more violence. There was an increase in the size and influence of prison gangs. Convicts were killing and injuring other convicts, attacking corrections officers, which in turn led to an expansion in administrative segregation.
One gate. Two gate.
The WIN unit is a maximum security unit. Well, segregation is the maximum security of a maximum security unit, so you're going to use a lot higher security precautions than you would.
This is one of the older ANSEG units.
Shake them down.
Here, the inmates are permitted out of their cells every day for the brief walk down the hall to the showers.
Open your mouth. Raise your arm.
The men are strip searched.
Big and boss.
Their clothing is examined. Then, before they're taken out of their cells, the inmates are handcuffed. Two guards escort each man down the hall behind a rolling shield that protects them from assault by other inmates. Otherwise, the only breaks in the day come at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of WIN prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting.
How much, man? No, before he... he loses his manhood. That's the way I see it.
I've asked you a lot of questions. Anything you want to say?
Yeah, Ted, all we want, man, is for, whatever reason you all is giving this story, we hope it be a two-sided, story, tell both sides of it. See, most people out there in America, they could care less about us, right? They feel like, lock them up, make them do as much time, make it as, hard as possible. But it's also another, side, to it too, is that people still need to be treated, human, man. Even though we are here rightfully, because you can't send us back out there, into the world, all angry, without no hope, man. All that's gonna do is cause more and more problems.
There is another side to the story. There is always another side to the story. The victims of the crimes that put these men here, they are neither seen nor heard in this place. The correctional officers who walk the corridors with such authority and so much power, many of them, especially the newer officers, are in fact poorly trained, underpaid, and often very afraid themselves.
Slowly, 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 do not run. Now break apart, break apart.
These men and women are trainees, applicants for the Texas Department of Criminal Justice.
Open them up. Get your eyes open, force them up.
It burnt. It set your chest real tight, couldn't breathe.
What is good news for the rest of the country, low unemployment and a booming economy, is bad news for the Texas Department of Criminal Justice. At a time when the system is desperate for reinforcements, when the number of inmates has tripled since 1989, the cream of the crop, the best candidates, are opting for better paying, less dangerous jobs.
And now that's what I'm gonna do.
This is a place where they test you though, isn't it?
Yes. I'm gonna do whatever it takes to survive while I'm in this place.
The reason I joined was because while you're in here, you know, you're not gonna be able to do your time by yourself. Physically, you could do your time. I could do my time physically. Mentally is what you need support in, not only with your family, but with other people. What we're about is brothers. We're brothers, which is we help each other out financially, mentally, you know, physically.
If someone wanted to opt out, if someone said, I've had enough, I don't want to be a part of the gang, I want to leave, you can't just resign your membership.
No, sir, you cannot. Blood in, blood out. That's what this is all about.
I really can't go into it, you know, the details. But, no, you can't just say my membership has expired and I'm just gonna...
Functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor, but this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. ADSEG at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact. And you can see the sky.
You are eight.
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others. But then, too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the ADSEG unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, your mouth, flip, turn, turn around. Left foot, right foot, bend over, spread your cheeks.
Everything went SOP, standing.
For almost half an hour.
I gotta ask you, Willie, you could play the game, right?
Right.
You could play by the rules. You could say, all right, I'm gonna keep my nose clean and I'm gonna try and make it out of here.
Right.
I don't get the sense that's the way you're made, though. I mean, you look upon this as kind of a challenge. I mean, I've got to say, I have sort of grudging admiration for you, but you know, there's an easy way and there's a hard way.
If you lose control over yourself, you'll never get it back. I mean, it's easier to be on the outside looking in and, you know, judging, you know, it's like this here.
Place.
The reason I joined was because while you're in here, you know, you're not gonna be able to do your time by yourself. Physically, you could do your time. I could do my time physically. Mentally is what you need support in, not only with your family, but with other people. What we're about is brothers. We're brothers, which is we help each other out financially, mentally, you know, physically.
If someone wanted to opt out, if someone said, I've had enough, I don't want to be a part of the gang, I want to leave, you can't just resign your membership.
No, sir, you cannot. Blood in, blood out. That's what this is all about.
I really can't go into it, you know, the details. But, no, you can't just say my membership has expired and I'm just gonna walk away. It doesn't work like that.
And if you tried to do that?
Well,
there are consequences.
There's consequences for everything. Unfortunately, the consequences on my situation, well, they're pretty bad. I'll just put it to you like that.
You ever thought about quitting the gang?
No.
Why?
Because there's a lot of consequences. The consequences is death. I don't want to die.
Discipline is the hallmark of the prison gangs, but what terrorizes their enemies also keeps their own membership in line. At this cell block, where members of the Mexican Mafia are held in administrative segregation, this is the quietest, best-behaved unit in the prison. K Block, a still prison high security unit. There is no angry yelling or banging on doors here.
Turned around, bent over. Didn't spread his cheeks.
Giving you a direct order now, like bend over and spread his cheeks. Hey, people, strip search.
And I said, here we go.
Let's redo it and do it the right way. Yeah. I'll go get the OC and we'll get it right. Yeah. So you're gonna deal with it now, or if I go get the OC.
All I'm saying, man.
All I'm saying is you're gonna do it. Or I'm going to get the OC pepper spray, and we'll properly strip search it in. So you need to go ahead and drop your doors and do what the officer tells you to do. What is it going to be?
See me. Look.
What is it going to be?
Since I've been here, man, y'all been talking about us, man, since we talked about business.
Go ahead and get the OC. He's refusing to proper strip search, so.
I'm not trying to cause no trouble, man. It's just that they be going beyond the call of duty trying to dog and abuse us, make us look like we are animals, dogs, something. Man, you know, we human too.
I'll tell you what, this is your opportunity to talk and give your story on TV, and you're fixing to lose it because you don't want to do a
proper
search.
I'm not trying to lose it, man.
Then get out of your doors. Let's go with it. Are you going to do it or not? Bob, get up here and do your strip search.
I told him, Mike Willie, that he had an opportunity to tell his story. And I told him he has this last chance, which he doesn't normally have. And he took it.
Put your lips. Put your hands. Pull behind your ears. Put your testicles. Put your arms and hands up. Turn around. Show me. Pull your feet, shoes off. Show them the bottom of your left foot and your right foot. Bend over and spread your cheeks. Okay, put your shorts on.
Let's get dressed and get on over there.
I feel like that it was unnecessary, that it was done for the main purpose to degrade me. They normally don't do it. They do it as a form of punishment.
The trip to the new high security and seg unit at Estella Prison takes just a few moments.
You don't have no view of the outside. And you have very few contact with other people and stuff. And,
how old are you?
21.
What are you in?
Murder.
What did you murder?
Next door neighbor.
Why?
Dope.
Willie Matlock is serving 25 years on a burglary conviction.
A lot of guys that came back over to where I was from over here, they was giving us horror stories and stuff. Like, you know, guys getting killed, they'd be refusing to feed.
To the ADSEG unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker. The officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, your mouth, flip, turn around. Turn around. Lift your left foot, right foot, bend over, spread your cheeks.
Everything went SOP.
Want to leave the same way I came. I don't want nobody to go in that has to go into the cell with me coming out getting injured.
Well, usually dealing with that inmate before usually just takes the gas on him. But every now and then he'll fight off the gas and want us to come in after him.
You got to be on your toes all the time. You just basically concentrate on what you're doing whenever you're in front of that cell door.
Officer Kimberly Driscoll is recording everything that happens on videotape.
The inmate, he was just acting abnormal. It's nothing new with that inmate. He just wanted attention.
This time inmate is complying with orders from allowing.
We went to the cell and the inmate, he complied to orders to have the hand restraints secured, so I secured the hand restraints. Once we've entered the cell and the inmate is subdued, placed on the floor, and when the leg restraints are secure, I let him know, leg restraints secure. When the hand restraints are secure, I holler, head, hand restraints secure. Anytime they have those restraints on, regardless if they're in behind his back or, you know, I've seen them bring them in the front. They can bring those handcuffs or hand restraints in front just as quick as you blink your eyes.
The inmate, as you all saw and witnessed, he complied. He gave us back the restraints and no use force had to be used, so everything turned out well this time.
At first started doing this, it was kind of, I guess, scared, you know, but pretty soon you get used to it. It's a normal everyday thing. You know, sometimes you'll wear this stuff for 2, 3, 4 hours, you know.
When you go in there, you have an adrenaline rush. Because when you go in, you don't know what the inmate's going to have, if he's going to have a homemade shank, anything like that. So you got to be prepared each time you go in, because you never know what to expect when you go in there. So you're always going to have an adrenaline high when you go in.
This incident was insignificant, but that is not always the way it goes. It's easy for resentment to build in a place like this. Cocktails, a blend of feces and urine at the guards. When we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to rely on lighting as far as day and night, and I'm not sure of days. It's been numerous days, I would say weeks, maybe even a couple of months.
But now we're supposed to be functional, individual, ready for release into society. Might be somebody's next door neighbor. But this is how you get treated. But they want you to act civilized in a cage, half hungry.
But has it worked? If the goal was to cut down on violence, it has. In the mid-80s, there was one murder for every 1,000 inmates. Last year, it was one in 15,000. ADSEG at Wynn Prison is tough. But at least there is some minimal human contact, and you can see the sky.
You got eight?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others. But then too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the ADSEG unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, your mouth, turn around. Left foot, right foot,
then over, spread
your cheese.
Everything went SOP,
standard. I want to lead the same way I came. I don't want nobody that has to go into the cell with me coming out getting injured.
Well, usually dealing with that inmate before, usually it just takes the gas with him. But every now and then he'll fight off the gas and those to come in after them.
You got to be on your toes all the time. You just basically concentrate on what you're doing whenever you're in front of that cell door.
Officer Kimberly Driscoll is recording everything that happens on videotape.
The inmate, he was just acting abnormal. It's nothing new with
him. People have long memories, right?
That's happening. I can't deny that.
You've been in here how many years?
About 17 years.
17 years in prison. How many years in ADSEG?
About 16.
Explain to me. I mean, you're a very eloquent and apparently a well-read man. Explain to me how a man survives that and keeps his sanity, as you clearly have.
Well, I just keep my mind occupied on whatever I paint, I draw, I write, I read, and I exercise and I keep active. I'm 55 years old and I try to keep in shape.
Are you in for life?
I've got a life sentence, and I'm trying to make parole.
Nobody seems to make parole these days.
No, there's no more parole in Texas. And I don't know, I guess I'm stuck in here.
Yeah, I've run into several men like you here, Joe, who are clearly very intelligent men, who have the self-discipline to teach themselves something that on the outside you would have had to go to law school to learn. And I guess the sad question is, why the hell didn't you do it when you were on the outside and when you had the chance to do it?
I guess if we had that answer, we wouldn't be here. I don't understand it myself. I don't know it.
I mean, just think, if you'd gone to law school, you could be on the outside helping get other young men out of here, right?
Yes, sir.
One young man on cell block K who may see the outside of prison before growing old is Speedy Garza, up for a parole hearing in June and general release in the year 2001.
Your family was here a few days ago to visit you.
Yes.
Does that make it easier or harder when you've seen the family?
Well, it's really hard. I can't show that I'm afraid or that I'm scared or that I miss them or that I'm tired of being in this place. I can't show very many emotions at that time. I have to try and be strong so that they can be strong. So I try my best to keep a smile on my face and make them think that, well, everything is okay.
While Speedy Garza meets with his family, nearby, a mother meets with her son. He has joined the Ku Klux Klan since coming to prison. Travis Poole is doing 20 years for two counts of burglary. He is 27 years old, an avowed racist, and a proud member of the KKK. He is kept in total isolation.
I've known him quite some time through his incarceration.
Barker is going to ADSEG for assaulting a guard, but assaulting a guard can be as simple as a verbal threat.
He's a very passive individual. He's also a manipulator by bad behavior. He might stand his own for a while until he decided to go the easy way out and maybe do a staff assault and get locked up.
Every time we leave, they strip us to make sure we don't get nothing. I'm used to it now. Happens every time we come out. Gotta get used to it.
The second prisoner awaiting transfer, Willie Madlock.
Mr. Madlock, you're going over to administrative segregation, is that correct?
Right.
Have you been over there before?
No.
You know what it's like?
No. No.
You have any idea?
No.
Everything was going fantastic. Just standard operating procedures. He got out of all his clothes, and then he was told to turn around and bend over and spread his cheeks, which he turned around, bent over. And didn't spread his cheeks.
I'm not going to do it. Giving you a direct order now, like bend over and spread his cheeks.
I'm not going to do it.
I said, here we go.
Let's redo it and do it the right way.
Yeah.
I'll go get the whole scene and we'll get it right.
You know,
so you're going to do it with it now, or if I go get the OC.
All I'm saying, man.
All I'm saying is you're going to do it, or I'm going to get the OC pepper spray, and we'll properly strip search it in. So you need to go ahead and drop your doors and do what the officer tells you to do. What is it going to be?
See me, look.
What is it going to be?
Since I've been here, man, y'all been talking about us, man, since we talked about business.
Go ahead and get the OC. He's refusing to proper strip search, so.
I'm not trying to cause no trouble, man. It's just that they be going beyond the call of duty trying to dog and abuse us, make us look like we are animals, dogs, something. Man, you know, we human too.
I'll tell you what, this is your opportunity to talk and give your story on TV, and you're fixing to lose it because you don't want to do a proper strip search.
Man.
Then get out of your drawers. Let's go with it. Are you going to do it or not? Bob, get up here and do your strip search.
I told him, Mike Willie, that he had an opportunity to tell his story. And I told him he has this last chance, which he doesn't normally have. And he took it.
Put your lips. Put your hands. Pull behind your ears. Lift your testicles. Arms and hands up. Turn around. Show me. Pull your feet, shoes off. Show them the bottom of your left foot.
Did with a comb. If I had a line of my own, I'd be expected to hook his with mine. And then I could draw his line with the letter into my cell. This guy is good enough, though, to do it without any help from me.
There's the fishing line, and somehow the men made across the hall managed to flick that comb under the door of his cell, across the floor of the corridor between our two cells, and under the door of my cell.
The letter was mostly about food. Says he's not getting enough, that he weighed 138 pounds at the beginning of January and is now down to 122. Nobody promised us a rose garden, he writes. On the same token, someone did promise us the rights of being human. He gets the letter to me just about the time my brief stay in ADSEG is over. He's happy, though, believing that I will get the news out to you. But if he thinks that most Americans will care, he has probably misread the public mood. It doesn't matter whether an inmate is a murderer or the writer of bad checks. Here in Texas, generally all inmates begin their sentences in the general population. But it is behavior that determines whether an inmate stays there or whether he must be segregated here in this prison within a prison. I sat down with the warden here at the Estelle Unit and with the director of the Texas Department of Criminal Justice, Wayne Scott.
Psychologically, boy, you talk about deprivation. You don't see daylight. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe two or three times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking at about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision for that reason. Because if we think somebody is a continuing danger to society, we want to do everything possible within our means to track that individual to keep them from creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical.
I've already been informed that and prepared that he was giving them problems in the main building, and in this case it was a strip search. So I'm perceiving a problem.
You have two staff assaults. Your latest one was on 7/10 of 97, which was striking nostril. I'm going to remain you a level 3, starting off here, and the next 30 days we'll reevaluate you again.
They had already made their decision. They were just going through the formalities. And, you know, I felt like I was being treated like, you know, like livestock or something.
He's got a stand-up posture. I see Willie doing exactly what he wants to do, or he thinks what he wants to do. I told Willie, I don't see you having any problem over here as long as you do what's mandated. Do you have a problem with that? And his answer was no, sir.
This also done created a whole lot of, you know, mental problems. I would be willing to believe of half the people over here on some kind of psych medication. Being locked up in these cells 23, 24 hours, 7 days a week, most people break after a year or two. Most people break.
Yesterday, when I went to Willie Madlock's cell in cell block C, we talked for almost half an hour.
I got to ask you, Willie, you could play the game, right?
Right.
You could play by the rules. You could say, all right, I'm going to keep my nose clean and I'm just going to, I'm going to try and make it out of here.
Right.
I don't get the sense that's the way you're made, though. I mean, you look upon this as kind of a challenge. I mean, I've got to say, I have sort of grudging admiration for you, but you know, there's an easy way and there's a hard way.
If you lose control over yourself, you'll never get it back. I mean, it's easy to be on the outside looking in and, you know, judging, and you know, it's like this here. Person can only submit so much, man. You know, before he he loses his manhood. No, that's the way I see it.
I've asked you a lot of questions. Anything you want to say?
Yeah, I'll tell you that. All we want, man.
Yeah, the then part here, I don't think that anymore. I've been here long enough at least to know that no matter what the noise is out there, you can sleep. And as long as you're sleeping, the hours pass fairly quickly. But the daytime, when you sit here sort of wondering how you're going to fill the day, that's going to be really difficult in this place.
There's a guy on the other side of the cell block indicating that he wants to send me a letter. The technique is called getting online, or fishing. He's flicking out a line weighted with a comb. If I had a line of my own, I'd be expected to hook his with mine, and then I could draw his line with the letter into my cell. This guy's good enough, though, to do it without any help from me.
There's the fishing line, and somehow the then made across the hall managed to flick that comb under the door of his cell, across the floor of the corridor between our two cells, and under the door of my cell.
The letter was mostly about food. Says he's not getting enough, that he weighed 138 pounds at the beginning of January and is now down to 122. Nobody promised us a rose garden, he writes. On the same token, someone did promise us the rights of being human. He gets the letter to me just about the time my brief stay in ADSEG is over. He's happy, though, believing that I will get the news out to you. But if he thinks that most Americans will care, he has probably misread the public mood. It doesn't matter whether an inmate is a murderer or the writer of bad checks. Here in Texas, generally all inmates begin their sentences in the general population. But it is behavior that determines whether an inmate stays there or whether he must be segregated here in this prison within a prison. I sat down with the warden here at the Estelle unit and with the director of the Texas Department of Criminal Justice, Wayne Scott.
Psychologically, boy, you talk about deprivation. You don't see daylight. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe two or three times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision.
Right. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe two or three times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking at about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision for that reason. Because if we think somebody is a continuing danger to society, we want to do everything possible within our means to track that individual, to keep them from creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical professionals in there three or four times a week talking to those people. We don't want somebody to become fully psychotic, and if we can catch them early on and get them shipped out for treatment, and that's why we try to keep such a close eye on that.
Little psychosis is okay. Huh?
All of us have it.
We talked to a Harvard psychiatrist who specializes in solitary confinement. What he talks about is acute sensory deprivation. That's the most difficult part.
I can understand where the isolation.
Their clothing is examined. Then, before they're taken out of their cells, the inmates are handcuffed. Two guards escort each man down the hall behind a rolling shield that protects them from assault by other inmates. Otherwise, the only breaks in the day come at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells.
You can play the game, right?
Right.
You can play by the rules. You can say, all right, I'm going to keep my nose clean, and I'm going to try and make it out of here.
Right.
I don't get the sense that's the way you're made, though. I mean, you look upon this as kind of a challenge. I mean, I've got to say, I have sort of grudging admiration for you, but. But, you know, there's an easy way and there's a hard way.
If you lose control over yourself, you'll never get it back. I mean, it's easier to be on the outside looking in and, you know, judging. And you know, it's like this here. Person can only submit so much, man. You know, before he he loses his manhood. That's the way I see it.
I've asked you a lot of questions. Anything you want to say?
Yeah, Ted, all we want, man, is for, you know, whatever reason you all is given this story,
we hope it be a two-sided, you know, story, you know, tell, you know, both sides of it. See, most people out there in America, they could care less about us, right? They, they feel like, lock them up, make them do as much time, make it as, hard as possible. But it's also another, side, to it too, is that person, peoples, I still need to be treated, human, man. Even though we are here rightfully, cause you can't send us back out there, into the world, all, angry, without no hope, man. All that's gonna do is cause more, more and more problems.
There is another side to the story. There is always another side to the story. The victims of the crimes that put these men here, they are neither seen nor heard in this place. The correctional officers who walk the corridors with such a
standard operating procedures, he got out of all his clothes, and then he was told to turn around and bend over and spread his cheeks, which he turned around, bent over, and didn't spread his cheeks.
Giving you a direct order now, like bend over and spread his cheeks. Hey, people in the strip search.
And I said, here we go.
Let's redo it and do it the right way. Yeah. I'll go get the OC and we'll get it right. So you're gonna deal with it now, or if I go get the OC. All I'm saying is you're gonna do it, or I'm going to get the OC pepper spray, and we'll properly strip search it in. So you need to go ahead and drop your doors and do what the officer tells you to do. What is it gonna be?
See, me, look.
What is it going to be?
Ever since I've been here, man, y'all been talking about us, man, since we all been here.
Go ahead and get the OC. He's refusing to proper strip search, so.
I'm not trying to cause no trouble, man. Just that they be going beyond the call of duty trying to dog on abuse us, make us look like we are animals, dogs, something. Man, we human too.
I'll tell you what, this is your opportunity to talk and give your story on TV, and you're fixing to lose it because you don't want to do a proper strip search. Then get out of your doors. Let's go with it. Are you going to do it or not? Bob, get up here and do your strip search.
I told him, Mike Willie, that he had an opportunity to tell his story. And I told him he has this last chance, which he doesn't normally have. And he took it.
Put your lips. Put your hands. Pull behind your ears. Lift your testicles. Put your arms and hands up. Turn around. Show me. Pull your feet, shoes off. Show them the bottom of your left foot, your right foot. Bend over and spread your cheeks. Okay, put your shorts on.
Let's get dressed and get on over there.
I feel like that it was unnecessary, that it was done for the main purpose to degrade me. They normally don't do it. They do it as a form of punishment.
The trip to the new high security and SEG unit at Estella Prison takes just a few moments.
And you don't have no view of the outside. And you have very few contact with other people and stuff. And,
how old are you?
21.
What are you in for?
Murder.
What did you murder?
Next door neighbor.
Why?
Dope.
Willie Matlock is serving 25 years on a burglary conviction.
Likes to touch her children even when they're grown. I've touched him one time in almost 5 years. And it hurts. It hurts a lot.
They talk about hatred, about his membership in the Klan. She and her husband raised their son to respect all races.
Some of the things that I tell him is not real nice about it. Some of the words I say to him about that's very harsh.
Very harsh.
She tells him to keep his hatreds to himself.
and I hate it. And I ask him not to tell that. I'm very ashamed of that. I'm very ashamed of that.
Where does that come from?
It does not come from me or his father. It comes from prison.
So you got in here because of drugs and burglary.
Yes, sir.
How'd you end up in ANSEC?
Well, I had a couple of fights, inmate assault, and weapon possession. You know, when you first come in, you get attacked. You see, if you're a man, they call it checking. You're gonna fight. You don't get jumped on by one inmate. You get jumped on by four or five. Right. And after you fight one group of racists, you fight the other ones.
But you're in here then because you were in fights a lot?
I've had a few fights. I had about four fights and stuff like that, and four weapons possession.
So what does the Klan do for you in a place like this?
Well, they write letters. They call the warden. They come up here when their members are having problems, stuff like that.
So you communicate with them the way you communicate with your family?
No, so it's on a different level. My parents and my family are not racist, quote racist, and they're against my beliefs. My mom don't even talk to me about it. She tells me I'm a fool. You know, she hates it. She don't believe in it.
So why do you do it?
Well, I believe in it now. I believe in it.
Well, I'm still a little confused as to what it is that made you. I mean, you say
they was carrying somebody there.
Well, if I understand you right, you say you don't hate black people, you don't hate Jews, you don't hate Mexicans, right?
That's right.
So is it a question of racial superiority? Is it a question of one race being better than another?
No. Well, God put everybody on earth for purpose, and we all got our place and time. And I feel that we were the best ones. The white people are the best ones.
White Christians?
Yes, sir, white Christians.
There's a lot of black inmates on this cell block.
Yes, there is. Yeah. That's why I think they moved me over here.
Now, does that bother you being on a cell block with a lot of African Americans?
I'd rather be around white supremacists if you
had your choice.
Yes, sir.
But we talked to your mom after she came to the visit, and she does disapprove. I
mean, she don't like it.
She doesn't think you're on the right track.
Won't miss anything.
Always, always. Shake down an area, okay? This is another thing that we're inspecting for, okay? Things like this. These things have been found.
They will confront men who are dangerous, angry, often psychotic. Men who have nothing but time on their hands. And those who are assigned to the ADSEG unit at Estelle will always have, in the backs of their minds, the knowledge that most of those inmates were considered too dangerous to leave in the general prison population.
We're supposed to punch him, abuse him?
No, sir.
Kick him?
No, sir.
I would not say they're unqualified. Our training does meet minimal standards for correctional officer training. I do believe that the training should be increased.
In point of fact, the demand is so great, the training has been decreased from 6 weeks to four.
I think the training, if you listen, is adequate. I mean, to protect yourself.
Defensive tactics is designed for the self-protection of the correctional officers. It is a limited familiarization program of 10 hours, and all we can do is familiarize them with the techniques. We had originally requested that we be allowed to train in defensive tactics for 40 hours. So that there would be more hands-on practical application of those exercises.
From here, this here is a straight-on block.
Training has been cut. Standards have been lowered. A year ago, the washout rate was 10%. It's down to 1%. Many of the trainees are out of shape, but if they're going to trim down and toughen up, they'll have to do it on their own time.
Let's say he has a shank. Did he say he slammed 41?
As long as they have never committed a felony, as long as they have not been convicted of a misdemeanor during the past 5 years, as long as they have graduated from high school or passed an equivalency exam, they are qualified to be trained as correctional officers in the state of Texas.
The correctional officer of today is entirely different
a totally different picture, a totally different person than the correctional officer of years gone by. But I feel that the desire within the person is still there. They may not possess all the skills, all the mechanics about it, all the technical qualities, but if the desire is there, we can do a lot with it.
Which is another way of saying, what else can we do? For a starting salary of $18,000 a year, almost any adult in Texas can work at a high-risk, high-tension job.
I come in every day thinking my life will be in danger.
Sensory deprivation. That's the most difficult part.
I can understand what, you know, where the isolation could affect an individual's mind. But again, they chose to be there. We did not put them there. They chose to be there.
That's, I mean, look, this is a place where everything you do has consequences.
Yes, sir.
This is also a place filled with people who didn't get that when they were outside in the world. They always thought the consequences didn't apply to them. So the question is, how well did the teaching methods work?
It's obvious that they're not working. And again, that goes back to the individual, what he wants to take in and what he does with that information when he gets
it. The great fear, I think, that people on the outside may have, I'm talking about civilians, when they see this series that we've been doing, is the implicit message here is you've got men who are so incorrigible, so tough, so violent, that they can't make it here in the general prison population where they're surrounded by people just like them. But once they've done their time in ADSEG, they're out on the street. I'd be a little concerned if one of those fellows was moving into my neighborhood, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes, sir, I'd be concerned.
And what's the answer?
There's no hope for that individual, in my opinion. He was aggressive, for one, to get into ADSEG, and he was probably aggressive before he came to the penitentiary, and he's going to continue to be aggressive when he gets out.
But if anything, he's a little meaner, a little tougher, a little more psychotic than he was when he got here in the first place.
Yes, sir, I'm not going to argue that point either.
You're the mayor of a big and tough city here, and you've got to take control of this place and maintain control of this place, but let me ask you to put your warden's hat aside for a moment. Just talk to me now as citizen figure.
I'm at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh.
We did not put them there. They chose to be there.
That's, I mean, look, this is a place where everything you do has consequences.
Yes, sir.
This is also a place filled with people who didn't get that when they were outside in the world. They always thought the consequences didn't apply to them. So the question is, how well did the teaching methods work?
It's obvious that they're not working. And again, that goes back to the individual, what he wants to take in and what he does with that information when he gets it.
The great fear, I think, that people on the outside may have, I'm talking about civilians, when they see this series that we've been doing, is the implicit message here is you've got men who are so incorrigible, so tough, so violent, that they can't make it here in the general prison population where they're surrounded by people just like them. But once they've done their time in ADSEG, they're out on the street. I'd be a little concerned if one of those fellows was moving into my neighborhood, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes, sir, I'd be concerned.
And what's the answer?
There's no hope for that individual, in my opinion. He was aggressive, for one, to get into ADSEG, and he was probably aggressive before he came to the penitentiary, and he's going to continue to be aggressive when he gets out.
But if anything, he's a little meaner, a little tougher, a little more psychotic than he was when he got here in the first place.
Yes, sir, I'm not going to argue that point either.
You're the mayor of a big and tough city here, and you've got to take control of this place and maintain control of this place. But let me ask you to put your warden's hat aside for a moment. Just talk to me now as citizen figure.
I'm at mealtime. The rest of the time, they read, they write letters, they draw pictures, they sit.
Basically, I just lay around, read my Bible all day.
The noise, though, never stops.
There's noise all the time. I mean, this go on all night, 24 hours a day, all night long.
This is cell block B4 of Wynn Prison, where prisoners classified as level 3, the most dangerous inmates, are housed in converted solitary cells. These men are permitted neither privileges nor personal effects. Cell doors are covered with heavy mesh. That keeps the inmates from throwing what they call correctional cocktails, a blend of feces and urine, at the guards. When, we ask, was the last time he was outside?
I'm not actually, as far as dates, I'm not sure. I have to...
At least there is some minimal human contact, and you can see the sky.
You got eight?
The new facility at Estelle, high-tech, computerized, sanitary, is much tougher. They all agree on that. The administration, the inmates, the correctional officers, all agree that they've managed to squeeze out practically every vestige of human contact at Estelle. The inmates there suffer from acute sensory deprivation.
You know, as you can see, there's no windows. You know, there's the shower. You know, you don't leave at this period. This can be very depressive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, you got people, like I say, that ain't as strong as others, but then too, you know, some make it, some don't.
It is just a few hundred yards from the main prison at Estelle to the ADSEG unit. Two inmates to be transferred a few hundred yards to another world. The young white inmate, David Barker, the officer in charge, Captain Steve Gaylor.
Put your hands up, put your mouth. Turn around. Lift your left foot, right foot, bend over, spread your cheeks.
Everything went SOP, standing.
I want to lead the same way I came. I don't want nobody to go in that has to go into the cell with me coming out getting injured.
Well, usually dealing with that inmate before usually just takes the gas with him. But every now and then he'll fight off the gas and wants to come in after him.
You got to be on your toes all the time. You just basically concentrate on what you're doing whenever you're in front of that cell door.
Officer Kimberly Driscoll is recording everything that happens on videotape.
The inmate, he was just acting abnormal. It's nothing new with that inmate. He just wanted attention.
This time inmate is complying with orders. Mm-hmm.
We went to the cell and the inmate, he complied to orders to have the hand restraints secured, so I secured the hand restraints. Once we've entered the cell and the inmate is subdued, placed on the floor, and when the leg restraints are secure, I let them know leg restraints secure. When the hand restraints are secure, I holler head, hand restraints secure. Anytime they have those restraints on, regardless if they're in behind his back or, you know, I've seen them bring them in the front. They can bring those handcuffs or hand restraints in front just as quick as you blink your eyes.
The inmate, as you all saw and witnessed, he complied. He gave us back the restraints and no use force had to be used, so everything turned out well this time.
At first started
identifying because they were marked. Okay, now they've gotten smarter because we have started locking, you know, a lot of them up now. So that makes it harder for us, and we do it through the correspondence. We search their cells.
Selling contraband, you know, selling things, you know, extortion.
This man is a member of the Hispanic gang Barrio Aztecas, doing time in administrative segregation.
All my time I've been back here.
The rest of your time?
The rest of my time I'll be back here. And each time I keep coming back to prison, I'm gonna be back here.
How does a little guy handle himself in a place like this? See, by himself.
Even small people need to learn to maintain their own respect amongst others, especially in prison. If I have to go as far as using some kind of weapon to defend myself, or if I have to go as far as putting myself on the line to maintain my respect, then now that's what I'm gonna do.
This is a place where they test you, though, isn't it?
Yes. I'm gonna do whatever it takes to survive while I'm in this place.
The reason I joined was because while you're in here, you know, you're not gonna be able to do your time by yourself. Physically, you could do your time. I could do my time physically. Mentally is what you need support in, not only with your family, but with other people. What we're about is it's brothers. We're brothers, which is we help each other out financially, mentally, you know, physically.
If someone wanted to opt out, if someone said, I've had enough, I don't want to be a part of the gang, I want to leave, you can't just resign your membership.
No, sir, you cannot. Blood in, blood out. That's what this is all about.
I really can't go into it, you know, the details. But, no, you can't just say my membership has expired and I'm just gonna walk away. It doesn't work like that.
And if you tried to do that?
Well,
there are consequences.
There's consequences for everything. Unfortunately, the consequences on my situation, well, they're pretty bad. I'll just put it to you like that.
You ever thought about quitting the gang?
No.
Why?
Because there's a lot of consequences. The consequences is death. I don't want to die.
Discipline is the hallmark of the prison gangs, but what terrorizes their enemies also keeps their own membership. We installed two tiny wide-angle cameras in the cell, and I brought in a Hi-8 camera that would permit me to keep sort of a video diary. You can't expect to reproduce the desperation that must come with knowing that you're going to be locked in a cell like this for the indefinite future, but the hope was that if I spent 12 or 14 hours here, I might gain a useful insight or two. I was put on C-Wing. This is the cell block they gassed a couple of weeks back. Almost all the inmates here are level 3, which is to say they have very few privileges to begin with. Since the incident that provoked the gassing, they have no privileges. The entire cell block is on lockdown.
Hard to know where to begin. The noise. They locked me in here about 8:30, and about 8:40, the banging started. One of the inmates, a few cells down, just banging on his door, banging on his door.
The microphones on these Hi-8 cameras are not too good. The steel and concrete makes the cells kind of echoey to begin with, and the noise, even without the banging, rarely lets up.
Since that time, just a lot of yelling. Some of it, I'm sure, is yelling back and forth, cell to cell, people communicating with one another, but a lot of it is just yelling, just people giving vent to their frustration, their anger, their madness, whatever it happens to be.
Normally, if that's ever an appropriate word in this place, normally meals must be an important break in the monotony. Since the lockdown went into effect, they're part of it.
Had my first jummy, my first sandwich, peanut butter and jelly. Not the best peanut butter, not the best jelly, but hamburgers. Still, the notion of having peanut butter and jelly 3 times a day, they've had it now for 10 days. They've been on lockdown since the 16th. I can see how they get old real fast. The theory of behavior modification in this place is as simple as it gets. Good behavior is rewarded, bad behavior is always punished. Food is an instrument of reward or punishment.
The knowledge that people can walk by this cell, if they're so inclined, if for one reason or another they want to punish the person in here and forget about breakfast or forget about lunch or maybe forget about all three meals in a day.
You expect me to sit back and accept this? This is the only way I've got to communicate.
It's easy for resentment to build in a place like this. Small things loom large, and sometimes, even if you have a legitimate beef, nobody is inclined to listen. Sometimes inmates engage in pointless acts of rebellion.
Most people don't understand. By putting your arm out here and refusing to pull it back in again, they're going to come for you. So why are you doing it?
Because Mr. Coffin is like this right here.
Is now down to 122. Nobody promised us a rose garden, he writes. On the same token, someone did promise us the rights of being human. He gets the letter to me just about the time my brief stay in ADSEG is over. He's happy, though, believing that I will get the news out to you. But if he thinks that most Americans will care, he has probably misread the public mood. It doesn't matter whether an inmate is a murderer or the writer of bad checks. Here in Texas, generally all inmates begin their sentences in the general population. But it is behavior that determines whether an inmate stays there or whether he must be segregated here in this prison within a prison. I sat down with the warden here at the Estelle Unit and with the director of the Texas Department of Criminal Justice, Wayne Scott.
Psychologically, boy, you talk about deprivation. You don't see daylight. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe two or three times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking at about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision. For that reason, because if we think somebody is a continuing danger to society, we want to do everything possible within our means to track that individual, to keep them from creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical professionals in there three or four times a week.
Talk to other inmates. This is their first, this is a prototype. We're building several others, and the question ought to be, where do they go from here?
Actually, the crime that gets you sentenced to prison in the first place has nothing to do with whether you spend time in administrative segregation.
Stick it out a little bit further, Davis.
Some of the most violent criminals are model prisoners. While some of the men convicted of lesser charges, like burglary, or selling marijuana, or driving while intoxicated, end up here because they resorted to violence, for one reason or another, in the general prison population. And once they're here, whatever got them here, they have to deal with solitary. And a lot of men can't.
I mean, he strikes me as being a little psychotic, is he?
He strikes me that way too, yes, sir. Some days he's on, some days he's off.
I've seen people just completely have lost their mind and say they're completely crazy. Talk to themselves. They play with their own waste. You know, they just, those type of people, you know, I really can't say what they do when they get out. They can't conduct themselves in here, so I doubt they can conduct themselves when they get in the streets.
95% of these individuals will be out on the streets again. That's the statistic.
That's how many get out. And when you house them in these settings, you're costing us as much money as you possibly can. This is the most expensive way to house a prisoner. So you're going to ultimately get prisoners out sooner, and you're going to get them back to our community in the most violent and crazed and disordered state that you can possibly have them in.
A Still prison psychologist, Dan Busby, disagrees.
Sometimes it has absolutely no effect. It's absolutely nothing to them. Then other people will have some effect from the derivation of stimulus. But I find that's a very small percentage.
I have the spirit of God in me. That's right. I'm the son of God.
The percentage may be in dispute, but there is general agreement that this place drives men mad.
Yeah, it really do. If it got several guys on this wing that went nuts.
The people, some of the people behind those is crazy, but me, I feel lost, lonely, I cried a lot.
We have learned, we now believe, how to build the prison of the future. It may be a few more years before we can accurately gauge the full measure of what we've achieved. Solitude is a precious thing, but only when it's a matter of choice. In this place, you're left with very few choices. Here, solitude is the constant reality that governs your life, and
his answer was no, sir.
This also created a whole lot of mental problems. I would be willing to believe of half the people over here on some kind of psych medication. Being locked up in these cells 23, 24 hours, 7 days a week, most people break out of it. After a year or two, most people break.
Yesterday, when I went to Willie Madlock's cell in cell block C, we talked for almost half an hour.
I gotta ask you, Willie, you could play the game, right?
Right.
You could play by the rules. You could say, all right, I'm gonna keep my nose clean and I'm gonna try and make it out of here.
Right.
I don't get the sense that's the way you're made, though. I mean, you look upon this as kind of a challenge. I mean, I've got to say, I have sort of grudging admiration for you, but you know, there's an easy way and there's a hard way.
If you lose control over yourself, you'll never get it back. I mean, it's easy to be on the outside looking in and, you know, judging, you know, it's like this here. Person can only submit so much, man. You know, before he, he loses his manhood. No, that's the way I see it.
I've asked you a lot of questions. Anything you want to say?
Yeah, Ted, all we want, man, is for, you know, whatever reason you all is giving this story, we hope it be a two-sided, you know, story, you know, tell, both sides of it. See, most people out there in America, they could care less about us, right? They feel like, lock them up, make them do as much time, make it as, hard as possible. But it's also another, side, to it too, is people still need to be treated, human, man.
Large, and sometimes, even if you have a legitimate beef, nobody is inclined to listen. Sometimes inmates engage in pointless acts of rebellion.
Most people don't understand. By putting your arm out here and refusing to pull it back in again, they're gonna come for you. So why are you doing it?
Because Mr. Crawford is like this right here. For 8 days, I've been in a cell with no personal hygiene, no toothpaste, no shampoo, no deodorant, no nothing. Just for 8 days for something I ain't even done. And just, if you go to them and try to talk to them and let them know what the problem is, they just look the other way and just keep on going.
C-Wing is on lockdown because of something that happened 10 days ago. Since that time, the prisoners here have been kept in their cells 24 hours a day. The water turned on for just a few minutes at a time every couple of hours. There have been no hot meals, just bologna and peanut butter sandwiches for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And, like the man said, no toilet articles either.
You were here when they sprayed the gas the other day?
On the 16th, you wouldn't believe how many people, how close they come to killing people.
Some inmates say it started over the eggs. A couple of men thought they were entitled to 2 eggs for breakfast, and they were getting only one. Most everyone else seems to agree that it began when 12 prisoners were moved over here from D-Wing.
And in the process of moving these inmates over here, moving other inmates over, we shook down D-Wing, and we was in the process of shaking down C-Wing.
When you talk about shaking down the wing, you mean searching all the cells?
Yes, sir, searching the cells.
Right.
And looking for contraband. The inmates in C-Wing started creating a disturbance in the fact that they were beating and banging and kicking on their cell doors to where I felt like there was imminent property damage fixing to take place.
I mean, even in the short time I've been here, there's a lot of banging that goes on. I mean, there's a lot of frustration. That pounding the cell door seems to be, you know, one of the favorite activities around here. I mean, this is one of the few quiet moments we've had in the...
Oh, this is the banging that I'm talking about. I'm talking about kicking the light fixtures, trying to kick the light fixtures out, kicking the cell doors to where they're rocking off the track, and trying to cause destruction of property.
Not everybody on the wing was beating and banging on the door. There was nothing out of hand. At the most, it was 8 or 10 people beating and banging. Just about 3, maybe 4 people at the most.
In this situation, the warden had violated a procedure, denying the prisoners an opportunity to have their property.
Psychologically, boy, you talk about deprivation. You don't see daylight. You have the freedom of your cell, and then, as you say, maybe once a week, maybe 2 or 3 times a week, you get to spend an hour doing chin-ups or push-ups or shooting a few hoops.
Well, remember that we're talking at about a very small number of people system-wide.
I understand.
That go into this.
I'm only thinking about that one guy. When he comes out and he moves back into my neighborhood, they're worse off. Some of them are worse off when they come out than when they went in.
Well, I won't debate that issue with you. I will tell you again that our release mechanisms allow us to put those people under super intensive supervision for that reason. Because if we think somebody is a continuing danger to society, we want to do everything possible within our means to track that individual, to keep them from creating some harm to the public.
If someone is borderline psychotic, putting that person in pretty much total isolation for 23 or 24 hours a day is not designed to help his mental health.
That's true, and that's why we have the medical professionals in there 3 or 4 times a week talking to those people. We don't want somebody to become fully psychotic and before, if we can catch them early on and get them shipped out for treatment, and that's why we try to keep such a close eye on that.
Little psychosis is okay. Huh?
All of us have it.
We talked to a Harvard psychiatrist who specializes in solitary confinement. What he talks about is acute sensory deprivation. That's the most difficult part.
I can understand where the isolation could affect an individual's mind, but again, they chose to be there. We did not put them there. They chose to be there.
Look, this is a place where everything you do has consequences.
Yes, sir.
This is also a place filled with people who didn't get that when they were outside in the world. They always thought the consequences didn't apply to them. So the question is, how well did the teaching methods work?
It's obvious that they're not working. And again, that goes back to the individual, what he wants to take in and what he does with that information when he gets it.
The great fear, I think, that people on the outside may have, I'm talking about civilians, when they see this series that we've been doing, is the implicit message here is you've got men who...
They have no privileges. The entire cell block is on lockdown.
Hard to know where to begin. The noise, or was this the first time? They locked me in here about 8:30, and about 8:40, the banging started. One of the inmates, a few cells down, just banging on his door, banging on his door.
The microphones on these Hi-8 cameras are not too good. The steel and concrete makes the cells kind of echoey to begin with, and the noise, even without the banging, rarely lets up.
Since that time, just a lot of yelling. Some of it, I'm sure, is yelling back and forth, cell to cell, people communicating with one another, but a lot of it is just yelling, just people giving vent to their frustration, their anger, their madness, whatever it happens to be.
Normally, if that's ever an appropriate word in this place, normally, meals must be an important break in the monotony. Since the lockdown went into effect, they're part of it.
I had my first Johnny, my first sandwich, peanut butter and jelly. Not the best peanut butter, not the best jelly, but the best. Still, the notion of having peanut butter and jelly three times a day, they've had it now for 10 days. Lockdown since the 16th. I can see how they get old real fast.
The theory of behavior modification in this place is as simple as it gets. Good behavior is rewarded, bad behavior is always punished. Food is an instrument of reward or punishment.
The knowledge that people can walk by this cell, if they're so inclined, if for one reason or another they want to punish the person in here and forget about breakfast or forget about lunch or maybe forget about all three meals in a day.
Water is normally turned on to the in-cell showers for 20 to 30 minutes a day. It can also be turned off. If a family member puts money into a prisoner's account, he can buy a few items from the commissary, even a radio with a headset. But radios are a privilege not available to prisoners on level 3, so there are no radios in this wing.